I found
and
it.
We are live. Ready. Hello, everybody. And hi, Lance.
Hi.
We're a little disorganized tonight. Apparently, they didn't hear my 3-minute warning, 1-minute warning, or 15-second warning. But hi, everybody.
We were gushing about Castlevania.
Are we all mine?
That's true. Castlevania is amazing.
With my headphones out? Are we all mine?
Yes, we're online.
Are we on the internet?
Are we on the internet? Yes, we're on the internet.
This is all going to go
down. Kevin, put your pants on.
Oh, this is history in the making.
How long have we been on?
Like 20 seconds.
Okay.
The whole time.
The whole time.
You guys want some bread?
I love some bread.
Some bread, bread? No, we were not paying attention, Zane. We were not. Or they were not.
No.
I was.
Haley was. Haley's the only one who listens to me.
Don't let me in with these.
I don't even know what the fuck Corso is up to, but.
Don't mind him.
Hair?
Don't mind him at all.
Anyway. Happy Tuesday, everybody. Welcome back to this week's episode of The Fae-Li. Super stoked to be back after our amazing giveaway all of last week, which was super exciting. And then Beyond the Realms yesterday, which was super sweet. And we get to dive right into tonight's episode with a whole bunch of stuff that's going to be happening.
We're going demon hunting, motherfucker.
I don't know. Maybe you are. Probably.
Who the fuck knows? Not us. That's who.
Just shit ain't a beach episode.
Yeah, exactly. Just shoehorn in beach episode. That's all we need. Awesome. So, with that, I don't believe we have any housekeeping stuff. So, let's go ahead and dive right in to tonight's episode of The Fae-Li. So, whoop, that is the wrong audio piece.
Oh. Wow, it looks like not even the DM's prepared at this one. Huh.
No, we're good. That's going to be really loud for a second. There you go. Alrighty, so.
We back.
We back. Last we left off. Having discovered what the group believes to be a Rakshasa's lair of some kind. Oh, why are we frozen?
I don't know, but Moose's face is really good if you look at it.
Okay, we're good. Okay. Apparently we're just having all bad stuff tonight. Hi, everybody. We're good. So, having discovered what the group believes to be the lair of a Rakshasa, they made their way through a large portion of underground tunnels below the city of Felderwind, a series of rooms full of demonic entities which they dispatched, butchering tables and blood of different kinds, bones from different animals and different humanoids. The group eventually found a heavy metal door with a devilish insignia emblazoned on the front of it. A seven-sided cut burrowed into the center, but in an attempt to open it, Phelan accidentally triggered a magical effect that put himself, Margo, and Les under the effect of a powerful sleep spell.
Don't be pointing fingers.
Nighty-night.
That's my job.
You're the one who touched it.
That's my job to do.
He touched the butt.
He touched the butt. But waking up, Phelan realized the group had overstayed their time underground and insisted that they leave immediately, making their way back up to the city of Felderwind in the late evening with a small journal they had found, seemingly documenting a series of initials and powerful archdevils within the Nine Hells. The group quickly departed across the city, believing that the red dragonborn Fialti's Blade Vein was one of the next targets of this entity. However, Phelan, finding a bit of time on his own in an outhouse, felt a sudden urge to make his way back in the city, seeking out the Watchmaster, Tobias Pedersen, to let him know of exactly what had transpired below the city, who he is, who his allies were, and what they had seen. But upon delivering this message, a bit of interest from the Watchmaster, but not quite the reaction one would expect. Phelan realized that he had been under the effect of the spell, drastically tried to leave, and the Watchmaster stopped him, asking a few additional questions once he had come to his senses. But Phelan was eventually allowed to leave of his own accord, and very rapidly made his way across the city to reconnect with his allies. On the other side, Margo, Jules, and Les had made their way towards Fialti's home, trying to track down the Dragonborn, make sure that he was safe, that he was alive. To no avail. He was not there, but his stuff his belongings were left behind in his room. They took those with a bit of convincing on Margot's part to allow them to take all of his belongings from his home and eventually head back towards the city while Galahad and Nebula had realized that Phelan was gone. Reconnecting with the group, eventually Phelan actually met up with them on the road and explained what had happened before the party had realized that the Altis had been called off by one of the Crown's Guard, seemingly being taken in towards the city for some reason, you're not sure. But without a lead and without any much left in the tank, as it were, hit points low, spell slots depleted, you decided to call it an evening and return back to the Fowler Manor, explaining the situation to Zacharias Fowler before eventually turning in for the night and getting a well-deserved sleep. So, with that, you wake the following morning, fully rested, spell slots returned, hit dice back, hit points full, and back at full. You have the day to yourselves.
And we're level 5 now, baby!
And you are level 5 now, baby. So, as you all awake in the morning, excuse me, the previous day's experience is taking their toll. Muscles aching, cuts and bruises slowly healing. There is a substantial amount of noise coming through the windows and walls around the Fowler Manor. Heavy thuds of boots, cheers, raucous laughter, with the smells of freshly baked goods wafting in. You're all in your individual rooms for the night.
Who's in my room?
All of you have your own rooms.
Oh. Well, if I smell freshly baked goods, I'm going to head down to that stand.
I don't have a nose.
All right. So,
yes.
Stepping out into the lobby, you see a series of banners. Decorations are in the process of being hung. Depictions of a blazing sun, candlelight, fresh flowers adorning every table and every wall. The dining hall is done up in similar fashion, with cornucopias full of wheat, fruit, and vegetables. Silver bowls filled with softly glowing orbs lighting the table. And Philip emerges from the kitchen, not in his usual formal dark suit, but instead in a tan jacket, light gray pants, and a bright orange-yellow handkerchief poking out of a linen cloth breast pocket.
May I roll a history check to see if this is something that I would know what the fuck is going on?
You certainly may.
I think he mentioned it last session.
Well, I mentioned it after we'd wrapped up, but you as players don't really know what this is.
Oh!
You as characters, sorry, don't know what this is.
Yeah. Oh, Kevin says I see our fourth wall and I break it.
That is a 14 plus 7 for history. So.
21, okay. Yeah, you know, having, you know, with the background that you have and kind of needing to know a lot of the things that transpire across the Empire, you know this as the Harvest's Rise Festival, something that is usually celebrated by a lot of the farming communities around the Empire, essentially making sure that they've met all of their yields of crops, they've had a good year. The Rise, the festival itself will be a celebration with a lot of the spoils that are left over, so a lot of food tends to be given out for free. There tend to be a lot of games and competitions of sorts, traditional things like that.
Harvest Rise, is that what you said?
Harvests. Harvest, apostrophe S. Yeah. The rise harvest. Of the harvest.
Yeah. As if Harvest was a person. It's his or her or their festival.
Harvest.
Harvest.
Yeah.
Harvest.
Harvest.
Jules will
Mike Tyson's festival. Harvest festival.
It's a Harvest festival.
Jules will kind of recognize that and turn to Philip and say, is this preparations for the Harvest Rise festival?
Oh, yes, I suppose you've been rather focused on your task since you arrived. Yes, tomorrow is the Harvest Rise festival. Yearly celebration of the bounty and the spoils left over from meeting the requests of Ruxyntrum for the Empire and the military.
That crept up, didn't it?
Well, I mean, it's been planned here for several weeks. The Staros is set to give an address to officially kick off the festivities at midday tomorrow, but everybody's already getting set up if you want to venture out through the city and see exactly what is so exciting about it.
Quick reminder, Jordy, what did the conversation with the uncle, how did that end?
Yeah, so the conversation with your uncle was essentially you went to him with everything that you had known. He confirmed two of the initials on the list were two of the people that he was missing. He didn't know, he knew the third one was the farmer. He didn't know one of the names that was left blank. And he didn't know, he didn't know either of the other two names that were left blank. But you believe that one of those was FB for Fialty's Blade Vein. He also confirmed that Rakshasas are entities that are very good at disguising themselves. And he used his eyes to be able to look at each of you and confirm that none of you were a Rakshasa in disguise.
For now.
Yet.
Did he give us any instructions or anything like that at the end of the conversation of what we were supposed to do the next morning, or...?
The conversation was more so around the fact that you've given a decent amount of information. Where you decide to take it from here is entirely up to you.
Got it. Okay. I just wanted to double check that because I couldn't remember.
Yeah. No worries.
Yeah, Jules will turn to the rest of the party and say, should we discuss our next plan of action over breakfast?
Yeah. Are we all in the same room? Like, because I thought we slept in different rooms, right?
Yeah, you've made your way out to the dining hall at this point.
All of us? Okay.
Yeah.
Yeah, I'm just scarfing down delicious morning pastries.
And there are quite a few. Yeah,
absolutely. Same. Right there with you, Les.
Now it's with a mouthful of food, be like, are we still gonna go down to the middle of town to get
Murdo gently sits down in front of a plate of like bacon and like just starts picking at it.
Burn that.
Are we still gonna go check out the center of this town? Isn't that where we're what we thought about heading to next? I.e. trapdoor land.
That's good. Yes, yes.
Yes. Unless you're so easily swayed that a harvest festival will keep you from doing our mission. No, I'm not entertaining the idea of a harvest festival, not when two people are missing.
I think that this would likely be a moment to strike for whatever sort of thing, Rakshasa or not, is...
I'm worried that if they may have the same idea, if everybody's distracted, what's to happen if one or two people go missing under their noses? They'll be so busy drinking their ale and sniffing their flowers, they may not notice.
Exactly.
So much flower sniffing.
I think that we need to definitely keep our guard up and keep our eyes peeled. I think that we should both look for the trapdoor, but also we need to keep an eye out for both Fialtes and Darius. See if we can find them anywhere since they went and spoke with
Watchmaster,
thank you. Since they both were taken to the Watchmaster, I think that knowing that they're safe would be a very good thing for us to assess.
Speaking of which, bit of a quandary here. And is Philip around?
Yeah, he's just kind of milling about, decorating the table, adding a couple of extra pieces to the walls.
Philip, question. Might you have a very good, fantastic even, portrait of said Watchmaster? Mm-hmm. I don't know if that's your thing. Philip, painting could be your thing, and I didn't want to rule it out.
Well, are you just trying to see what the Watchmaster looks like?
I am indeed. Kind of my thing, and I can't do
minor illusion in front of me. And show the image of the Watchmaster.
Okay. So, based on the description from Phelan, yeah, minor illusion, easily able to replicate that. You see a human man in his late 30s, auburn hair carefully pulled back into a knot, sprinkled with just the right amount of gray, a goatee to match, just a little bit of pepper here and there, weathered skin, but not rough, chiseled jawline, his beard kind of accentuating it even further. The only blemish is a rather large, long-heeled scar that runs from the right side of his nose, just below his eye, across his cheek, and down to just below his ear, so kind of back across his face.
Okay, and Nebula at the table will transform to try and mimic that image that he's looking at.
Yeah, it's not a hard image. Overall, it's, you know, just generally good-looking human man.
And in his new form, he goes, well, you never know when this might come in handy, and then shifts back into his base form.
Alrighty.
Just remember, don't say anything when you're dressed like that.
That's a fact.
Hello, I am Watchmaster.
That is true. I can't do the vocals until I've heard them.
Yeah. Oh, goody. Nebula can't talk.
So, don't worry. If anything happens, I can just punch you really hard in the throat, and then we've got our excuse.
I feel like then we also have to make an excuse onto why we're not
arresting. No. I quite like the idea of Nebula getting punched in the throat, actually.
Just a quick chop.
Judo.
Butler gets arrested.
All part of the plan.
We could figure that one out later.
I like his style.
Well, for what it's worth, the Watchmaster has been quite a decent man. I'm sure you'd be able to get an audience with him if you'd like.
Don't think so.
Thank you for the recommendation, Philip. But I don't think that we'll be doing that.
I'd rather hit up that trap door room while the getting's good. We don't want that lead to go too cold.
Yes, mm-hmm. I agree. I agree there.
Mm-hmm. All right. Well, do we want to try and, I guess, walk around town and guesstimate where this is going to be and get snacks on the way?
Not to be the one making the weird assumption here, but just a quick question, Phelan, as you have been there. Would you perhaps say that the Watchmaster's place of residence was in fact the center of town, if you were to spitball?
I would make the guess that... What, Jordy?
So, sorry, where you saw the Watchmaster last night?
I'd like to figure out if where I saw the Watchmaster would be close to where we estimate the middle of town would be, where the trapdoor would pop up at.
Okay. The Starosta's villa is much further south than where you think the trapdoor would be. And that was where you ran into him. You don't know exactly where his home is, but where you met him, where you ran into him inside the kind of governing mansion, definitely not in the middle of town by any stretch. It's much more on the south side.
Okay, so I would guesstimate that maybe not taking it out of all of our options, however... Not where I met him last night. I met him at the Starosta's house. So that would take that out. That's where his office seems to be, at least. I guess we would have to figure something else out.
All right.
Maybe he has, like, a house. Mm. He has a home down there. We'll find it.
Do we just want to nab some of these crispy little meat bits for the road?
Yes, and... Don't take too many, though, because we're going to buy some from the street. Best way to experience a place, get their food, like the local food. Blah, wonderful.
I agree.
Yeah.
As a person, I agree.
So Nebula reaches over and nabs a handful of the, like, meats that are up here.
Yeah.
Basically looking for, like, strips of bacon equivalent.
Yeah, there's some really nice cured meats. You've got some salamis with a peppered exterior. You've got some really nice dill and lemon kind of crusted sirloin cuts. And those are easily able to just be grabbed and snacked on.
Are there, what kind of pastries are there again? Are they just like Danishes or croissants? Or are there anything like...
You please, Jordy.
Yeah.
Yes.
So We are looking at...
You're gonna make me hungry!
Chocolate-filled croissants. You've got the log of chocolate in the center of the croissants. Yeah. We're looking at a couple of Danish-style pastries. So you've got some lemon, some orange, and some apples. Some nice tart citruses, so they'd be Granny Smith ones. You've got a lot of fresh rhubarb, a lot of fresh deep-dish pies. So you'd be looking at things like peach cobbler and assorted pieces of that respect. Anything that's kind of a nice, sweet, tart breakfast dish, especially heavier on the pastry side.
I'm gonna snag one of those Granny Smith tart looking things.
Sounds good.
Just pocket it.
I'm gonna get one of those chocolate filled homies, and I'm gonna get some of that meat, and I'll pull them together. I'll bite into it. I'm see
trifle.
If they go
well. It's called a trifle.
It's surprisingly good. The interior of it is a kind of a bittersweet dark chocolate, so you don't get the sweetness coming through. It seems to complement the lemon and the herb on the exterior of the sirloin quite nicely.
I'm gonna turn around to everybody else. You should try this. However, tell nobody else about it. I'm gonna figure out how I could like trademark this and then start selling it someday. But
Margo takes a questionable sniff and just makes a face like.
Don't judge it until you've tasted.
I will not be tasting it, and I will already have judged it because I'm
gonna insight check this pastry.
Divine
I
sense.
Love this chef sim. Let's just stay here the entire time.
So, all right. So, grabbing your little snacks, heading out into the town for the day.
Yeah, absolutely.
Something I need to note is as we leave the house, as Nebula like steps past the threshold of the doorway, suddenly appearing next to him is a hound.
What the fuck?
And he just hands down one of the cured meats without even looking in its direction, and it leans up and it just takes that, and he just kind of rolls his eyes and keeps walking and snacking.
Nebula, care to explain?
Less was this always here.
I don't remember seeing that, Emily. I think that's a new thing.
This is my companion. When a mission requires a little extra oomph, sometimes we're sent, for lack of a better word, a watchdog. And he just like looks at the dog, and the dog just like looks at him, and just like, Nebula just looks forward and he's like, it's a thing.
So we didn't meet him before.
So it appears as if not even your companions like you, and neither does the dog. Good doggy.
And the dog, what language are you speaking just now?
Just common, so everybody can understand.
Okay, yeah.
Margo roasts in common, so that way the whole group
can yeah, and the dog just kind of looks at you and then just like looks at everybody else and then just keeps walking by Nebula's side, and Nebula's like, all right, let's go. And he like looks down at the dog and he's like, I got this, dude.
You see the dog just kind of like look up at you and then just vanishes from sight, and then reappears on the opposite side of Nebula and is now looking up in the other direction.
I like the dog.
Yeah.
Oh, great. Another NPC for me to love and smother to death.
I don't like the implications, but I'm glad for the help.
I guess
it's dogs on our side.
I guess it's better than being monitored from your own head, but...
And he looks over, and Nebula goes, oh, no, he does that, too.
Y'all need some anti-malware software or something. God.
And just like looks down at the dog again and just like is staring for a long time, and the dog just scoffs. And that's, God. Yeah.
Oh, God. I would like to pet this dog.
Wait. What is the dog's name?
Gaia just goes up and goes, good doggy, come. Come here.
Jules is eyeing this dog, just like, I don't trust this thing.
Ruffle behind the ears, just a little quick one.
Oh yeah, absolutely. The dog's all for it. He sits there and 100% accepts that. I will say it is a very surprising looking dog to the rest of you, as it's got sunken in eyes and pointed ears and a long lion's like tail with its spine is sort of protruding up the back and these massive paws.
Nebula, I think you better feed that dog. It looks a bit skeletal.
Margo like gets down on the dog's eye level and goes, "Tell me, dog, do you dislike Nebula quite as much as I do?"
Just and it turns its head a little bit. Go ahead, Jordy.
Just kind of looks up at you. Narrows its gaze a little bit at you.
I don't trust it. I don't trust
it's it. Casting divine sense on me.
Oh, fuck, take a drink.
All right.
At this point, Margo just looks at the dog and goes, "I think we'll get along."
Those kind of gives you like a don't say that. Type of look.
Not gonna lie, I'm a little jealous.
What do they call your dog, Nebula?
And he looks over and he stares at it for a minute and he says some words. Can anyone here speak Sylvan?
That's a nod.
Yes, I can.
Let me check. No.
That was my third of four languages.
Excellent. DM Lair, thank you for the raid.
Yeah.
So Nebula looks at the dog for a brief second and says in Sylvan, "What do they call you?" And the dog just looks back at him and Nebula says, "Okay." And he looks back up and he says, "This one is Galaxy."
Galaxy.
Aww. I've never heard a dog speak Sylvan. That's pretty crazy.
Yeah, and you didn't hear anything from the dog's part.
Yeah. Oh, it's telepathic. Oh, okay. Yeah. The dog was just like, "Wee poo poo, je m'appelle
Galaxy." Je m'appelle Galaxy.
From the middle of the mountain, come to the back.
So, if he ever summons a cat, I'm assuming his name is like Cosmos or something like that.
Orion.
So there's a theme I see.
The cat's name is Orion.
Yeah.
Men in black.
Yay! Because the galaxy, yeah. Anyway. So, all right. Anyway.
Orion.
As you guys make your way out, the sun is blazing heat onto the. Oh, sorry, go ahead.
No, I was going to say, as we're walking through, I'd like to do something else, but didn't want to.
Yeah, no worries. I'll do the description, you can let me know what you do. So, sun is blazing heat onto the grass and through the city, as groups of families, workers, and townsfolk are starting to gather in different areas. Some are building makeshift stalls and structures, while others carry out large wooden tables and chairs, setting up around a partially built amphitheater of some sort. Everywhere you look, sun-shaped placards, bronze reliefs of Paelor the Dawnfather are being set up, and smiles are plentiful. Kids scramble through the streets with makeshift wooden swords and shields, chasing each other, colliding into the occasional ankle. Crown's Guard and Righteous Brand are present, but much smaller numbers. Looking out past the main area of the city, you see larger groups are dotting the landscape around the farms, and the vast majority of farmers do not seem to be paying much attention to their farmland today. So, Phelan.
Cool. I'd like to walk a little slower or faster to match up with Margo's pace, and as I do, I'll start unstrapping the straps to my shaman's claw, and as I do, I'll turn around to her and say, "You know, you didn't have much room for him, but this was an amazing reminder for me that Speck wasn't just the kobold that walked around with us, but somebody that we helped protect with the best of our abilities, and he was a friend to me. I know you try your best, and I want you to have this to remind you that you are doing your best." Pass it on over to her.
Margo, like, tentatively, like, sees what Phelan is offering and just kind of gently like takes it from him and then looks at him and goes, "I may have made a few misjudgments at the start. I was a hypocrite. For that, I am sorry." It appears as if I couldn't even take my own advice. If you know what I mean.
I absolutely do. I've definitely been in that boat once or twice or many a time. But you know what? We're here now, and we're working on fixing things, and we're helping people.
So how dare these people worm their ways into our lives?
Before this group and before friends, I figured it would be a life of superficial bombs, but here we are with people I genuinely care about.
Tell me, what were you like before all this?
You know, feels like it's been so long that I've been Phelan Rock, thief extraordinaire, I don't really know if I remember who I was before that, but I don't think, well, I think he would have disliked me more back then as a uptight asshole.
Well, I don't think anybody would have liked me at all. I am even safe to assume that people still don't like me as I am now. And that is their problem.
You're an acquired taste. I think we've gotten there now. And if they don't like it, they can fuck off.
So at that point, Margot just actually chuckles at that. And she just kind of quietly goes, I guess some people can't handle the spice.
Yeah, they'd be coughing all the time. Have you ever seen that? Somebody
okay, Phelan, that was a rhetorical statement. But I appreciate the offer. Yes, and once we get back to where spec is laid, I'll offer my proper respects.
I appreciate that. And every time I use these gifts, these new wings, and it feels like there's a little bit of him with me. And I think no matter what happens, you know, it's no matter who we lose, no matter who we gain, we'll always have a little bit of them with us. And I don't think, even if we part ways now, that I will be able to forget Margot, the brave dragon. Fiery to get there, but always there to help a friend.
Sadly, I think I've done a lot of things that'll make me unforgettable for both the good and the bad.
Who you murder?
Well,
like that one time you fireballed Les Paul.
I mean, who? At this point, I need you to ask more questions to help whittle down the pool of answers.
That's fair. You know, as much as I'd love to learn about your past, I do want to say that I don't really care what bad things you've done. You are here now and you're helping us now, and if those bad things are helping give you fuel, then so be it. But if they're weighing you down, then I will help you fight those demons, and I don't care what stands in our way.
I think we'll be doing a lot of demon fighting if unfortunate things come to pass.
yes.
Can I see him like break out in a cold sweat at this point? Like just failing like
100%. Oh, 100%. There's fucking demons. I don't care what he's been through. There's demons coming through. He's stressed. Demons.
At this point, Margot like kind of sees Phelan like sweating, and just goes, "Well, what's the worst that could happen, besides dying?"
Torture is one.
Oh, don't forget possibly being sacrificed to whatever Lord of Hell decides to take up your body.
Yep, losing our soul to those people also.
This could go quite horribly, you know, absolutely mangled, bloodied, and bruised. Do you think you're up for it?
Do you think they would shave my hair for if they, like, to torture me? I don't think I'd want
that. I don't think that'd be a good look for you, if I'm going to be entirely brutally honest. I honestly don't think. I would be quite ashamed.
I think that's where I draw the line. If they start shaving my hair, I'm going to have to run.
So that's how you make a bugbear cry wolf, is offering to shave it.
Yes.
You just gave us all prank ideas for the till the end of time.
Phelan, I'll give you a little bit of advice. I've been feeling that my fire grows a little bit more stronger lately, so unless you want to avoid singed fur, I will do my best to avoid you, but unless you want to end up like the fish fry back there that almost happened, I would do best to collaborate as to far getting out of my way, because even I don't know what I'm capable of now until I try.
I will say, though, I know you're getting stronger, but I'm also getting a little more nimble, so if you're going to be worried about people, I feel like Galahad is the least person you got to worry about, but then, like, I'm probably, like, 10 steps behind, but, like...
At this point, Margo turns around and looks at Galahad and just goes, you could punch Galahad in the face, and I think he might consider it a tickle.
When you turn around to talk to Galahad, I'm talking to him and be like, so it's not that I can exactly talk to fish, it's just that I can kind of suggest, like, where they may go next. And it's just like, that's just kind of...
That sounds like an extremely useful ability. I'm sure it'll come in handy.
No, you wait. It can be pretty helpful in some situations.
Galahad, you immediately remember back to when Les jumped into the water off the bridge, and you just saw all the fish scatter as he was eating one of them under the water.
God damn. So.
And the thing is, so Margo's just like, with my fire growing and Nebula suddenly getting a new pound puppy, and you with those fancy daggers of yours, I wonder what this party can do now.
So, Margo, you have the Shaman's Claw now.
Gopher's McGopher's Batman, let's get her done. Pitter patter, let's get at her.
Boomer sooner, baby. So
shout out to Ferroborn Trading for that awesome item.
Yeah. So with all of you kind of making your way into the center of the city, you can see that the city is in full bustle mode. A lot of shops being set up, a lot of outdoor stalls, a lot of wares already starting to be brought out from different shops from around the city. You're seeing quite a few different bakeries and different restaurants that are pulling out kind of appetizers, setting them up for different people to come up, and people are just kind of snagging them without real regard for any payment of any kind for the most part. It seems to be a very welcoming group effort. Essentially, as long as you're doing something, people are able to and willing to offer support in some way, whether that's water, drinks of different kinds, different food items, and so on. You know, pants get torn or replacement set ends up coming out, and a patch gets sewn on through stitching in a matter of minutes, kind of thing. But you have the day to yourselves. You are able to kind of push your way closer into what you believe the center of town is, roughly. And it seems like this square is pretty close to the center of town. The area where the amphitheater is being set up, where all the chairs are being pulled out, where a lot of the tables are being set up. It's kind of in the same general area as where you would expect things to be.
Do we lose any of the party members to the smell of food is the question.
Oh, I'm pretty focused on this, but... Okay, what do we...
There's no travel charcuterie board this time.
Charcuterie.
No, I'm too busy with my fucking chocolate eclair
bacon mashup.
Meat, yeah. Meat eclair, as it were.
Yeah, so how far are we from the center of town?
Sorry, say again?
How far are we from what we consider the center of town?
So it's a bit tough to say because the town itself is kind of three large circular areas. So you're kind of in like a Venn diagram, if you can put it that way, of three different circles. And this is kind of one of the central matching points of that. Based on the rolls that you guys made, you've got a vague idea of maybe like a, you know, 1 mile 1 mile square area of where you think the center of town, according to what you saw underground, is. There's a good 2 to 3 dozen homes that are in that area. There's a lot of different shops, you know, a couple of two-story buildings, some on the lower side. But this area that's kind of this open square is definitely a little more on the central side of where town is. Actually, if you take a look at roll 20 as well, I can show you.
Maps.
I forgot roll 20. I haven't opened that yet.
It's all good.
Same.
Whereabouts is Phelan in roll 20? Because everyone else is here.
He's too busy off the map eating his meat, Eclair.
I went off on another
secret
trip.
So stealthy, can't even show up.
I went to the bathroom again.
Oh, boy.
Oh, God. Whoa, what the hell?
Yeah, so you guys are kind of down to the right, and you can see that there's a lot of, like, those are just commoners that are wandering around, you know, setting up different stalls. You can see some of the stalls are being built on the left and on the right.
We're surrounded.
May I? Well. Can we all roll perception checks looking for any sort of, like, clue or sign in order to start our search? Now that we're where we think that it is to get started.
Okay, so the thing there is, what is it you're looking for specifically? Because you're in the vague area, like, is it a specific person you're looking for? Are you asking questions of other people? What is it you're looking to do?
Okay. Yeah. I think what Jules will do first, because she doesn't like dealing with people, is that she would look around at the architecture of all of the buildings, see if there is any construction being done recently, if there's any sort of, like, this is a small town, so I doubt it, but any sort of sewer grates on the ground in this square, anything that goes down.
Okay.
Any sign of basements and shit and all of that.
Gotcha. Okay, go and make an investigation.
Investigation?
Check.
That is a 8 plus, or a 9 plus 7, so 16.
16, okay. It's kind of tough to tell. Most of the buildings look to be built in and around the same time, which kind of makes sense. You see that there are a couple of newer buildings that are more on the two-story side that seem to be maybe just a little bit more advanced in their construction, but are very much slotted in where previously a lot of maybe larger rancher-style one-story buildings were made. That obviously the city itself has become more densely populated, so there have been other houses that have been built in a little bit here and there. You see that some of them have got shops on the main floor, and others have are just two-story houses with probably large families. Nothing really speaks to you as something that, like, is out of the ordinary or anything of any real particular interest.
Are there any shops or any houses around here that have basements?
That have basements? With that investigation check, you can see that there are a couple that have little, you know, those detached two-door ones that seem to be, like, you know, the basements that would be for housing wares of different kinds, external access, maybe to be able to pull out different supplies and be able to put a lot of things down into maybe store cupboards. And so you say out of the 2 to 3 dozen homes that you see, maybe, I don't know, 5 or 6 of them have one of those.
Okay.
Yeah. Les?
I would like to very gingerly kind of address anybody that's around me, one of the local villagers, and engage them in a conversation.
Okay. So you've got quite a few. You've got a variety of halflings that are all out and about, kind of working around. You've got some of the kids that are running around through ankles of different people. You guys are being given not a wide berth per se, but, like, you know, it seems like a lot of the people who are within the city know each other, so they are coming up and being a little more on the jovial side and chatting each other up. You see that there are a couple that are kind of off on their own, doing their own thing, hammers and nails going into boards. So
I'd like to address one of the, not the people working on something, like an adult who's maybe just, like, enjoying themselves around with the crowd.
Yeah, easy enough to do. You've got somebody who's just kind of having a couple of conversations while a few people are working. They seem to be a little on the heavier side, partaking in a couple of extra pieces of food that are being brought out for the people who are working, but they are kind of, like, feigning work and, like, you know, doing the one-arm hand-holding of stuff as they're just grabbing little bits of food.
Excuse me, friend. May I have a little bit of your time for 1 minute, please?
And you see them just kind of look up to you and, yes, what can I do for you?
No, I won't take much of your time, friend. My name is Trent Montgomery. I've been hired as a carpenter for the festival. I'm here to seek out renovations in some of the local structures nearby, make sure they're all in pristine condition. Just a little bit, lost my bearings a little bit. I'm new to the town, see? Looking for any of the are there any buildings around here that are built on top of cave structures? Anything that might be atop of some big spaces underneath that might have a thin flooring. I got to go rebuild some of the floorboards, you see, so make sure that the ground doesn't cave in on itself necessarily.
I understand. I can't think of any places like that off the top of my head. If anybody was doing any underground work like that, they would need to apply for a permit at the Starostas Villa. You maybe be able to talk to them and see if any kind of permits were issued? As a construction person yourself, I imagine you've probably already done that, though.
Yes, yes, of course. That's something that I would do. Yes, yes. This area over here is not built on any type of cave structures or anything of that ilk, is it?
No, the entire city is built on solid, stable ground. That's the reason why it's a bit away from the water, is to make sure that anything that is not stable is not down there, because otherwise the whole city could collapse in on itself.
Interesting, interesting. All right, you've been a great help, friend. Thank you very much. Just turn around and come back to the friends. Just
okay.
Like, turn around and don't even say goodbye.
And he just, like, starts mounting down and just, like, that was weird. But...
I'll come back to the party and kind of relay that information, just kind of be like, if there's any kind of cave system that any of the buildings might be built on top of, we could maybe ask the Starosa and try to get a permit to see if any buildings in particular might be on top of a cave system, but that's all I could claim at this moment.
And how exactly would we get a permit?
Asking? I mean, I am quite the carpenter, and I reach into, like, my satchel and bring out my carpenter tools. And a few pieces of wood that I've, like, whittled, and a couple of, like, horses that I've carved out of wood. It's kind of a passion of mine.
Huh. Bladevane was taken by Crownsguard. Is there any Crownsguard nearby that maybe we could ask where they could potentially go?
Could try.
Are there any Crownsguard around?
Yeah, there's a couple that are milling around. Definitely the majority of them seem to be on the outskirts of the city, just making way for a lot of the people who are building stuff. But there's definitely a few in and around the area, especially kind of flanking the amphitheater.
Okay. Okay.
Anyone want to go talk to them?
I would, but I might need a diplomat. Apparently I'm not very good at these things.
Let's go.
All right. So Jules and Margo heading over, and you see that there's a couple of Crowns Guard that are, you know, pretty equally spaced out. They're definitely looking a little on the bored side. These guys, you can see, there's a guy and a girl, and they're probably both just a little bit under 6 feet, very on the muscular side, even for some of the Crowns Guards that you've seen. They seem to have been chosen to be the ones who are guarding the interior of the city specifically, because they could probably hold their own in a bit of a fight. And it's just the two of them, one on either side of the amphitheater.
As we walk over, Jules is going to lean towards Margot and use Awakened Mind to be like, what exactly are we asking them about? I want to make sure that we know what we're talking about before we go into this.
Blaven was taken by a member of the Crowns Guard. Maybe the entire Crowns Guard was given a directive to take them to a certain place? Mm-hmm. Maybe they would know where they could possibly go. We could say... You apprehended Bladevane, Red Dragonborn. Where did you take him?
Let's perhaps ask about Darius first, since he's a member of the Crowns Guard and they're more likely to know him.
I mean, it could be if we needed to get an in, we could say we are here to help Darius with Bladevane. So maybe there was an issue and concern and we're called in for backup. Because obviously these Crowns Guard can't handle anything themselves.
Perhaps, but if we poke around too much, they might get suspicious. If he's working, if the Watchmaster is in fact the person that is doing this, he may have his guards on alert if someone goes poking too closely. Let's just see how it goes. Good afternoon.
So which one did you want to go up to? It was a female halfling and a male halfling. Oh, sorry, yeah, a female human and male human.
Yeah, I guess I'll go to the female one. I don't know.
All right, sounds good. So you kind of walk up, and she's been just looking around. You got a spear that's just kind of poked into the ground a little bit, and a couple of kids have been wandering around, and you see that she leans down and kind of smiles at the kids and shoos them away a little bit, and eventually walk up to her.
Yes, sir. What can I help you with?
I was just wondering, I met a Crown's Guard yesterday. He was wonderful, and I wanted to speak with him again since the festivities are on. I believe his name was Darius. Do you know where he could be posted today?
Point of clarification, Darius was the farm owner.
Fuck.
The Crown's Guard was Newlin.
Newlin.
Yeah.
Yeah, God. That's why he's on the top.
I know that you're not the best with notes, so it's all good.
I have it written down.
It's fine. So the amount
of correcting and backpedaling and correcting and backpedaling that just happened in the last 10 seconds.
It's right here. Can I just retcon that so I said the right name?
Yeah, absolutely. So that's fine. Okay. So Newlin.
Thank you. Yeah. Would you happen to know where? Would you happen to know where Newlin is posted today?
Newlin. I saw him coming into the city last night. Some red dragonborn with him. I don't know where he is today, though. I don't think I've actually seen him.
Where was he last night? A red dragonborn. Yeah. I only know of one red dragonborn, and that's her.
At this point, Margo just...
She just kind of looks at you and just... Good day.
Well,
evening.
It's 11 a.m.
again, this is why Margo is not the diplomat. you just get awkwardness when you throw me into social situations.
Right. Well, I was on patrol last night in and around the center of town, making sure any of the early festivities were not broken up. I believe Newlin said something about the Watchmaster wanting a council with this man. I don't know what his name was, but some red dragonborn that he was walking in. It didn't seem like anything too out of the ordinary.
Huh. Do you know who I could ask to find out where he's at? Any friends or whatnot? I'm new in town. I'm visiting my uncle.
you could approach the Starosta, or obviously just ask the Watchmaster himself. Apparently, if Newlin was going to see him last night. But I know that the Watchmaster seems to have taken ill today, so perhaps the Starosta.
Watchmaster's taken ill. That's
rather unfortunate.
Yes, especially on the eve of the large festival.
Jules and Margo both say unfortunate at the exact same time. That's definitely unfortunate.
But I'm sure that you could have a conversation with the Starosta. I believe that he's just shut himself in his office while he writes his speech for tomorrow.
All right, then. Thank you so much.
You're most welcome.
And Jules will back away, and as soon as, like, she's out of eyesight, just, like, drop the fucking... The
customer service voice.
The customer service smiley, like, oh, yeah, you know. Just, I hate doing that.
So while you two were off, Galahad, you had a lot of the kids coming up to you with little wooden swords and shields, just like nipping at your ankles, and you just hear the tang, tang, and you don't even feel it, really. Like, the kids are halfling children, so they're like under 2 feet tall. But they are just coming over to
you. Like a football.
Yeah, and essentially just tanging away with their swords onto your armor, and you can see all of them just like looking up at you and beaming at you, and the parents are just kind of, no, kids, come on, get away, it's okay, and just like, I'm so sorry, and apologizing for the kids as they're running. Roll initiative. Kids are common. It was 5 hit points and a -3 to hit.
Jordy, got a question for you.
Yeah.
What type of material are the buildings around here made out of?
That's a sus thing to ask.
That's the question of it.
That's a great question. The majority of them seem to be wooden frames. You can see that there is a decent amount of clay, some of them having brick exterior in certain areas, maybe add-ons to existing houses. But the majority of it seems to be wood and a little bit of metal here and there for the heavier structures that have any second story.
Okay. And the hatch that we're looking for, we all got to see the bottom side of it, right?
Yeah.
What would you say that was made out of?
the bottom side of the hatch.
Yeah, did it look metallic? Did it look stone? Did it, like, what did...
Did it look suspicious?
It looked to be, from the distance that you were at, clay or stone, possibly.
Okay. Okay, yeah. And we're pretty sure that we're within a range of what we're assuming to be the center?
Pretty close, yeah.
All right. Then Nebula has been thinking it through and just kind of looking over the area. And Nebula is going to cast
Divine Sense. No,
I was just going to say
Fine Trapdoor.
Well, I guess this is essentially Fine Trapdoor. Is going to cast this, but I guess Fine. I would ask you your ruling on how this works.
Okay.
I'm casting Locate Object.
Yeah. So.
And I have seen that. So.
We go.
Okay.
Big brain things. Thank Mark.
I gotta read Locate Object.
Yeah.
Because
the only thing that stops it is if there is a thickness of lead between me and the object, but I sense the direction of the thing I'm looking for so long as I've seen it.
Within 30 feet, which you have.
30 feet. Okay.
Yeah, because you were standing on top of the table, so you were 30 feet away from it.
Yep, and if it's within 1,000 feet of me currently, which is 3 football fields.
Yeah.
You're talking to the Canadians. Nobody's talking about football fields. What the heck? What's the direction?
Explain it in hockey rinks instead, if you could. Thank you.
Three curling arenas full.
Okay. Yeah.
That's right.
So.
I was hoping you're going with that.
So, yeah. It doesn't give you the exact object. You just get the direction to its location. Okay. Yes. All right. So, from where you are currently standing in the center of town, the object appears to be a couple hundred feet away. And you kind of like start to feel a little bit of a tug, and you look around, and it feels a little bit on the northwestern side of where you currently are, kind of up past where the amphitheater area is, and then a little bit further along. You don't have an exact one, and it is, you know, underground, but not by as much as you might expect. It seems to probably only be about maybe 5 or 10 feet below where you currently are, and more in a specific direction.
Okay. And yeah, so it's a concentration spell. I can keep this up for 10 minutes, and so Nebula's eyes just kind of faintly glow. And I think for Locate Objects, he has a different glow than his usual, because his Divine Sense is just a complete glossing over.
Yeah.
I think this is just like sort of a faint glow along the bottom of his eyes. It almost looks like he's tearing up. Mm-hmm. But like, it's just, and he's looking in a direction, and Nebula just starts walking in that direction.
Where's Nebula going? Nebula, it's all right. We'll find the place soon. Don't worry. I'm sure you're very useful in this circumstance. It's fine.
And he just makes a motion like this, but he doesn't say anything as he's like very concentrated on what he sees and senses. And he just...
At that, I'm going to...
Are Jules and Margo with the rest of the group at this point?
Nebula, I'm guessing you would have done this while they were off having that conversation, so I would say no.
Okay, yeah.
I'll follow along and try to stealth as much as I can to keep out of people's view.
Okay.
And I swear I thought you were going to like summon your hound to start... just start sniffing around.
I thought about it, but then I went, wait a minute. Wait a minute, I have a new spell.
So, Phelan, go and roll a stealth check for me if you're trying to stay out of sight as best you can.
Yeah, baby. Absolutely. By the way, my stealth is now at a plus 10, so let's fucking go. I rolled an 8 or a 28.
28, Jesus. In broad daylight, you vanish into a wall.
Chewbacca disappears.
You
get
lost in the crowd.
You like you all of you kind of like realize, hey, where did Phelan go? And then you just kind of like see this little head bobbing on the other side of a horse in perfect time as the two of them are walking down the street. And you just, the horse's tail is just a little extra bushy today as it is walking by. But Phelan, as best you can, you don't seem to be drawing additional attention. We'll put it that way. There's nowhere that you can like specifically hide out of sight, but you don't seem to be drawing any additional attention to yourself.
Assassin's Creed style, just blending in with the ground.
Exactly. Yeah, very much just blending in.
But, and I'm gonna just kind of stake out the area that Nebula's headed towards, but waiting on like, on his
direction. You're on.
I'll follow as well where they're going.
Sounds good. All right, so you guys starting to make your way through the city streets. Couple of left turn, or sorry, couple of straight and narrows for about 30 feet, 40 feet or so. A sharp left turn. You start to find yourself in more residential areas, a lot of homes, a couple of different smaller shops, or odd trinkets and bakeries and things like that here and there. And then a little fruit and vegetable cart being pulled across that you kind of have to sidestep a little bit until you eventually come to a sharp right turn. And the object that you were focusing on is getting a little bit more vertical to your look at it, and as it kind of gets a little bit more vertical, it vanishes. And you instinctively take a step back, and it reappears. So you feel like it seems like it's covered by lead, but the angle that you were at was enough for you to be able to bypass where the lead is. So you've got it down to now about four houses or so that are in kind of a square area. And you can see that each of them have got a letterbox outside.
Our arch nemesis, geometry.
Walls and doors.
Walls and doors.
So I can see the where I'm standing right now, there's like four houses and it's under one of them?
It's under one of them. They're in kind of like a little cluster, and you can see that each of them have got either a mailbox that's planted in the ground or something that's on the exterior. A lot of them have got a lot of the decorations that are up as well. So you see different sun figurines and palor what's it called? Insignias and things like that.
Do any of the mailboxes have like the name of the families that live in the houses or anything?
Yeah. One of the ones that you're right next to, you're able to look over and you see the last name of it says Hyde.
Jekyll?
Do any of the names on the mailboxes sort of match the initials of anyone on the book?
Guys, Newland Hyde.
Newland Hyde.
That's one of them.
This is why we write shit down, guys.
Is the note taker.
Or rather, why you didn't separate the group and Jules could have been like, you idiots.
That's it. We got to the first door.
Feli, open up!
So the first one that you notice does say hi. Do you want to take a look at all of them? Or just...
I just wanted to see if any of the other
are all the names.
If any other mailboxes match any other names as well.
Okay, so you see that two of them do have names on the exterior. The other two have got kind of like drawings and handprints of different sizes. You could imagine probably families of some kind. But one of the ones on the opposite side, so four pieces of the corner, one of them being Hyde, and the opposite corner is Pedersen.
Okay.
And you see that out in comparison to the others that have, you know, different family attributions, you've got little, you know, painted on hands of different sizes for the different kids and family members. Some of them got a lot of flowers outside. This one looks to be a little bit more subtle. You see that there are military insignias on the exterior, and you see specifically that there is the sigil of the town, of the city of Felderwin, on the exterior of it as well.
I want to kind of gather everyone in close for a minute and just start to whisper.
Huddle.
So one of these, obviously Hyde, that matches up with the name. If we want, I could cast Fog Cloud to give us a bit of cover going into these houses so it's not too obvious. It's up to you. Just a suggestion.
Well, hold on. Hyde is on the list, but isn't that other one there? And you said it was...
Pedersen.
On the list, Lance, isn't Pedersen one of them?
Newland, Hyde, Hector, Corkin,
Dad? Wow, I can't spell my own
Daddy
name.
Daddy Patterson? I knew it.
Daddy Patterson?
Daft Punk.
Jen,
Daft it's a D-A, maybe a T or a K, U-S.
Okay, first off, it's not even a D-A.
Why?
Lance, you it's a good it. Thing you're going into the arts. That is all I can say. That or a doctor, and that's the only thing you're handwriting.
Someone, how has the dyslexic one been given the role of note taker? What's his name? How do I spell his name?
You guys know that the item smuggler was Hector Corcoran. The farm liaison was Daxus Wiltrum.
There you go.
The farm owner was Darius Finn. The crown's guard was Newlin Hyde. And then obviously the farm hand was Fialti's Bladevane.
So Noah Pedersen.
But we know that name. God.
You do recognize the name. Phelan, you specifically recognize the name as the thing that you do not want to run into.
Hey, yo, is they first name Watchmaster?
First name Watchmaster, second name Tobias.
Watchmaster Pedersen.
Oh, fuck. Okay, cool. Okay, cool. Okay, cool. I'm going to, this point, pop up and come up to the crew. I don't think Hyde is who we're looking for. You might... Looks like you were right after all, Nebula. Watchmaster lives right here.
Oh. Phelan, my dear boy. I believe our Watchmaster has been dead for a long time.
Yeah! Bam, bam.
So, at this point, with them having found the house, we'll jump back to Margot and Jules. So you two kind of turn around and you realize that the boys are gone.
Yeah, Jules turns around, and as we're walking away, the persona drops, and she's just like, I hate doing that, and then looks around and is like,
I said good evening instead of good morning. I said good evening instead of good morning. I said good evening instead of good morning.
that's the least of our problems.
I'm a horrible diplomat. Why do you insist on making me do this?
I didn't insist upon anything.
This is why I bring you, so I don't say things like this. It's embarrassing for me, don't you understand?
You should learn how to talk to people better. I think that's a very skill to know.
I have not surrounded myself with people very frequently. You have to give me a pass every so often.
Well, I only grew up with my parents and my siblings, and somehow I managed to speak.
But you're not the only one with familial issues, Jules.
That's probably also because I was sent through a lot of lessons in order to know how to speak. Anyways,
Oh, now we're flexing. Now we're flexing our fancy upbringing. I see.
Our group is missing. They walked away. Why do they do this?
How do we lose a bugbear and a warforged?
They walked away while we weren't looking.
And you don't cherish
Can them. I roll a perception check to see if I can spot anybody?
Roll a perception check for me.
Oh, that is a 13 plus like a 6, I think.
Can Margo, like, because she's taller
than Jules. No, perception's a 2. I got a 15.
15.
Can Margo, because she's taller than Jules, also look around as well? Sure. I just want to roll the dice. It's been a while.
Sure. What's your short ass at? 4 foot five or 5 foot three?
Yeah.
No, that's just Haley in real life.
Yeah. Oh, my bad.
Hey! I'm more moderately sized than fun size. Thank you. Oh, I am not...
Can I get an insight check on that, Jordy?
That's a...
Bitch, I'm only 5 foot six. Don't come for me.
Oh, that's pretty good.
All right. Pretty so, tall. Margo, what was your perception?
Oh, my God. I only got a 10. That's so, it. Like...
Okay.
So, if I put Jules on my shoulders, he'll probably have a better advantage, though.
All right. So, Jules, you didn't really notice the people themselves, your allies themselves, but you noticed that a lot of the kids were really sad that the big metal man went that way. And they kind of point down one of the alleys, and they, like, are starting to sword fight with each other, but not quite the same vigor that they had when they were just hacking at his ankles.
Okay. Yeah.
Big metal man. Yeah. I wonder who that could be.
Nebula.
Nebula.
Who knows?
All right. So you guys are able to easily catch up with them as they're kind of figuring out the names and looking around at the buildings, and you're back as a six group now.
As Margo and Jules approach, Jules just has her arms out, just like, why did you walk away? Why did you walk away while we were speaking with
them? Was it Nebula? Did Nebula put you up to this? Was it Nebula's fault? It was
probably Nebula, yeah.
It's always Nebula's fault. Was it Nebula's fault?
How about we take this conversation to a corner, maybe an alleyway where we're not in wide view?
As you see Phelan just step out of the darkness in the wall. At 28 perception or 28 self-check.
He just phases out of the shadows.
The reverse me. Homer Simpson. So.
Yes.
He's like right behind us. We didn't even notice. He's like, follow me.
So you guys ducking into a side alley?
Yeah. It looks like we have found the very unfortunate location of two targets, possibly. But this is where the Watchmaster lives, as well as where our Crown's Guard, Newlin Hyde, lives.
All right, then.
Nebula was very good at tracking.
How did you manage to find this?
You notice as well that as you guys start talking about there, it seems to be a little bit more of a raucous noise and some of the music starts to pick up from the center of town. It seems a band has begun to gather and some drums and guitars seem to be coming out and string instruments of different kinds. Sorry.
I'm missing all the fun!
And you get to continue.
There better not be any murder.
Nebula says, I have ways of tracking things and luckily, one of the things I saw firsthand I was able to follow, specifically the door, the hatch, comes in a little handy.
I see.
Well, actually, no, I'm the one who saw, but, don't want to give all the credit to you.
Okay.
We gonna make a move, anyone?
Yeah, I'm Nebula saying, says, like, no, Jules, it's a festival. We're about to go attack a Watchmaster and maybe slaughter a whole bunch of bad people.
I can enjoy the festivities when this task is over with.
When do the festivities end? I want to make sure that we end this before we do that. We can set our own deadline, like 4 hours to spare, and then we can get drunk at the festival. It'll be great.
You said Jules knows this festival, right, Jordy? So would she know how long it is?
Yeah, you would know that the festival is usually 2 days. It's usually midday on one day is kind of when the festivities really start. And that would be the day before the actual festival itself. And it goes into the early evening. And then it is kind of a hard stop at sundown because the whole celebration is a festival of light. It's a festival for Pelor, the Dawn Father of the harvests, of the crops, and a lot of the things that transpire during the day. So there is drinking that continues into the evening, but the festival itself kind of wraps up around sundown. And then it starts up again at crack of dawn the following day, and then it reaches its culmination midday on the second day. And that's usually when some kind of large announcement is made, usually some kind of a large offering from the city or from the empire is distributed amongst the people.
So correct me if I'm wrong, but we have tomorrow and the next day.
You have today and the next day.
Today and the next day.
Yeah, today until sundown is the festival, and then tomorrow midday is the culmination. That's the highest point, and then everything kind of peters off after that.
Got it. Okay, yeah. Jules will turn to Phelan and just say, well, let's just say we have today to figure out the rest of this issue. And if we can get it done today, we can celebrate tomorrow. So let's get to it.
So here's the thing, right? I was kidding about the celebration. You're right, though. And thinking about it, this is probably when everything's gonna happen, because I know we mentioned this earlier, so fuck. Okay, cool. Drinks it is. Do we want to sneak in? Maybe split up, have a group make a distraction, and have the other group jump in to figure out if the location is in the Watchmaster's house? Well, I guess. Well,
if we're pretty sure that it's in the Watchmaster's house, we could sneak in through whatever way we want. I could cast fog cloud outside of the house to keep anyone from looking in or anyone being suspicious if anything goes awry. doesn't block sound, but visually no one would be able to see us through windows. If anyone got smashed through a wall or anything, no one would be able to see it from afar. The noise from the festival is covering for most
right.
of it probably made, so at least we have that option.
And I can open up the door. It'll be no problem. So, okay. That plan sound good to everybody, or is there any alternatives? Or, I guess, no need to split at all?
I say that we should stick together as best we can. I don't think we should all go into one house at once, but definitely not both houses at the same time, just in case we find what we're looking for.
Okay. Cool. Okay. Okay. All right. We go to one house, then we come out and figure out the next.
All right.
I want to start with the Watchmaster then, because there's a I feel like there's a higher chance with him.
Yeah.
We might find, you know, death and what lies beyond the veil there, but that's fine.
So your average Tuesday.
Yes. Okay.
Well then, why don't we go introduce ourselves, and Nebula will transform into
God damn it. Amazing.
Jules's uncle.
Oh God.
Okay.
Well, this can only go swimming, right?
And
do you remember the cult secret handshake?
Do you think maybe you might be better being a Crown's Guard or somebody actually trustworthy?
Fuck.
You're not technically Crown's Guard.
Oh, well, see,
from town.
My idea is someone of power in this city is, at the very least, not going to have a door shut on them. You'd have to answer. A Crown's Guard could just be bored.
Oh, I'd love to see somebody shut a door on you, but I suppose this is the best plan that we've got.
You're not wrong.
Besides, if anything goes sour and he does think your uncle did it, he'll probably attack your uncle and your uncle will have to slaughter him for us.
That sounds like the worst possible outcome.
But it's still an outcome, and he just starts walking out of the alleyway.
Jules will go with you.
Okay. Cool.
I'm coming.
So Nebula, Jules, Les, Phelan, you going?
Absolutely.
Margo?
Is going to be a little bit more of reconnaissance outside again. Like, okay. Not everybody needs to go in, and I do best crowd control.
Yeah. Use that high perception.
Actually,
that ability to not smack your friends in the back of the head.
Yeah, I'll do the same in case we need to, like, have a crew.
Margo's going to look over at Les Paul and be like, well, fish fry, I suppose I'm with you then.
Yeah, he's going in.
Wall of water.
No, I'm going to stay out with Margo then.
You're staying out with Margo?
Yeah. I think that as Jules sees Les approaching, just kind of like looks him up and down, is like, you're not the quietest person I know.
You haven't seen me work.
And a bunch of people in the city just kind of look over and just go at the sound of the knuckles cracking. Because it's literally like snapping like the back of a lobster, like cracking the shell as the knuckles snap.
I hate it so much. I haven't seen you work, but I have seen you freak out at my awakened mind many times and almost.
That's fucking terrifying.
She'll open up the awakened mind and go, I don't know what you mean.
Doesn't work twice.
Mm.
Only the first time.
And the, like, five other times after that.
There's only one head. There's only one voice that speaks to my head, and he's much more polite than you.
Who's that? Everybody got voices in their head except Phelan? I don't want voices inside my head. I take that back.
Telepathically,
don't write
Nebula is going to tell Galaxy to hang back and keep an eye on things and let Nebula know if anything happens. He can telepathically communicate with me so long as we're within 1 mile.
Okay. And so you hear him just kind of look up at you and just... and then starts to take a step back.
Yeah. Margo's going to hang back. I'm going to hang back outside and be the outside force.
Yeah. And Galaxy can just make his way over to you and just kind of perfectly heals right at your ankle and just sits and just starts looking sideways from both directions. All right. So, Galhead, are you going in or are you staying outside?
Who's going in?
Les,
right
Jules,
now,
and
I'm
Nebula.
Going in disguised as the uncle. And Les and
Jules.
or side by side.
Bang into the wall outside.
All right.
I'll go with Nebula.
You go with Nebula. Okay. So four of you heading inside. So Nebula, go up and just knock on the door.
Yeah, and it's Tobias, right?
Tobias Pettersson, yeah.
Yes, and I knock on the door and say, Tobias, and I call out.
A couple seconds pass. No response.
Tobias, so I have some questions about the announcement for tomorrow, and I bang a little bit louder.
10 seconds pass. No response.
Don't look good.
Yes, it is me. I'm here with a few. You haven't met my niece yet, but we'll get to that. Yeah. Well, if you need it, absolutely. And I just open the door.
Okay. Door's locked.
Of course.
Do you already?
I said I opened the door. Oh, God.
Playing with improv, bro. Say yes.
Yes, and? It seems your door seems to be damaged. Don't worry, I brought a handyman. And I just look at Galahad.
That was not the name I was expecting to hear. I brought a handyman. Kong.
Can Margo hear all of this?
Yeah, he's literally just saying it out to the street.
So Margo and Galaxy are like in the street, and we hear this.
You see Galaxy dog. Just kind of do the.
Yeah, I look at the dog, and then I look at Phelan.
Are there any windows?
And I know Big Boom soon to follow.
Geordi.
Yeah.
25.
For a strength check.
Yeah.
I was going to say, did we even get to that point yet?
Well, he pointed at me. I'm like, okay. So I'm just like...
All right. So I'll get you guys to take a look at roll 20. Give me a sec here. I'm going to give you a reveal of some areas. So you know kind of what you're looking at.
Oh my God, Geordi. We can't show that on screen. That is scandalous.
That's why you subscribe to the OnlyFans, man.
And screenshot.
The only rolls.
Only Faye.
Yeah.
Only Faye.
That was the Faye lie all along.
Only Faye, no lie.
Only Faye, no lie.
Scoundrels, all of you.
No cat.
So you see the house has got a couple of trees around the outside. You can see a little walkway going up to the front door of it on the side there. There are a couple of windows that are around the outside that you guys have been able to see from the different sections that you've passed by. But the door is kind of what you're walking up towards. It's on the
left
side.
Where's our tokens on the map? Is it this part here?
Yeah, it's on the left-hand side, so you can... I'll just slide you guys over there. So, currently, this is Nebula, this is Jules, and this is Les. Oop. Hey, that's where Phelan was. He was hiding under Les.
Whoa there!
And then we'll
Where's
save
Galaxy?
It.
Does Galaxy get a token?
Oh, yeah. Well,
Galaxy will get a token, not today, because I did not prep one, but there I will make a token for Galaxy.
Just take the shadow dog from Fiend.
Yeah. So here, I'll...
How about Divine Dog from Jujutsu Kaisen?
Yeah. Yeah, there you go. That's what you need. Alright, so...
I gotta watch that show more.
Dude, it's so good. It's so good. Give me one second.
Thank you, Geordi. We love you, Geordi. You're the best,
Thanks, Geordi. Geordi. Lord and Savior, Geordi.
He's what I do, he's what I do.
For Sugar Daddy, Geordi.
He's what he do, baby.
A, B, and C.
What it do, baby? Okay, why is this game so weird?
Geordi treats us so good. We never leave Geordi.
Why is this? There we go. There we go. Okay.
So how about that there door, huh?
Yeah, so you've got that door. That's kind of what you're knocking in on what right door? Now.
Yeah, right?
There we go.
The Galahad-sized hole through the door.
So yeah, so is that what you actually wanted to do? Did you want to just knock the door down?
I was gonna like take the knob and just
just shove
Smash
forward.
It through.
I'll have a rogue like 10 feet away who can like just pick through the lock.
I was called the handyman. I was required.
I'm sorry, but good uncle seems to be a person who grabs the bull by the horns. The bull happens to be a mechanical giant man right now.
The cast removed door. Thank you.
All right. So on a 25, you just kind of do like the rocket fist and then impacts against the door and it splinters quite heavily and the door itself cracks and caves in. The lock is still in place, but the door is like pretty much off its hinges at this point, and you are easily able to just slide it in and then rip it sideways so the lock is pulled out.
A gesture for Nebula.
And Nebula will just push it open and go, "Wow, Tobias, my dear friend and colleague, it certainly seems like that door of yours is really busted. We'll get someone to look at that."
And you see that you've definitely drawn the attention of a couple of people in town, but with the guys that you're currently in, nobody seems to be paying overly large amounts of attention to you. A couple of people notice and recognize who you are and just kind of like hurry the rest of their families or anybody who's with them away from your current position. So
good.
All right. So as the door gets opened,
mind your business.
Stepping in, you see a simple, humble setting with a small door immediately on your right and another door on the far side of the room. The walls are straightforward. Sturdy wood, single tapestry depicting fields and animals, and a small hearth fireplace set into a stone chimney. Facing it are a pair of well-maintained but still worn dark tan couches and a large easy chair, all surrounding a square dark red rug on the floor.
Tobias, like, I paint Tobias as a person who has a ton of, like, stuffed animals that Tobias has personally killed.
Has it been more than 10 minutes?
From where you are now, it has not been more than 10 minutes.
All right, so my locate object is still on, but I know correct. We've said that, like, it's covered by some form of lead.
That is correct.
Cool.
So I'm going to reveal the interior. There you go. So that's what you're looking at.
So Nebula will step inside, and as he does, looks around the room and doesn't see a door anywhere and doesn't quite get the sense that there is one yet, right?
Of a trapdoor?
Of the panel that I'm looking for.
From what you can see currently, no. You've got two doors and then a big rug in the room. That's about it.
Nebula is actually going to try and change the angle at which he's standing, and he's going to get down on the floor and lay flat and just like sort of look across the floor.
Okay.
Seeing if he can get like even a corner of a ping.
All right. So you're just getting as low as you possibly can, single eye, just get, and you don't seem to be getting anything.
Yeah.
I took one ping myself.
And then I stand up and I look back at the other two and say, "Well, Tobias must be in one of the other rooms," and proceed forward. And with his foot, he'll kick over the carpet as he walks by.
Okay. So the carpet is a little bit on the larger side. So you're kind of like hooking your foot under there and you throw it up as best you can. And as you do,
it's the floorboard.
It's the fucking lead carpet.
Hey, here we go.
As the rug shifts out of the way, you see a very few small gaps in the floorboards and notice a wooden handle that lies almost perfectly flush with the store floor with a very thin sheet of solid lead over top. Lifting the handle, a well-oiled hinge silently opens.
Well?
It's our trap door. Do we want to open it just to be sure?
Well, yeah. The last time we opened one of the doors connected to that room, it did erupt into flame.
I can cast Mage Hand just like Phelan can. Let's just take some steps back and I'll open it. We'll open it from a distance.
All right.
Cool. So I guess we'll get out of the way and Jules will cast Mage Hand and the skeletal spectral hand will go out and open up the latch.
very okay. slowly.
So, very, very, very slowly.
Very, very slowly.
Opening up the latch. Lifting the handle, the hinges open silently. You're looking down at a ladder that descends for about 2 to 3 feet into a heavily lit space below the house, about 35 feet down. Familiar purple flames are lit in 8 braziers at the base of it.
Well,
the ladder seemed to be attached to the back of the, or it seemed to be kind of attached to the wall, and it wasn't really visible from where you are, and you see that it is something that will extend as you get further down.
Damn! Could a mage hand grab that ladder? Fuck. We were so close.
From the direction you were, it didn't seem to be something that was there before. It seems to have been added since.
Added?
It was not there when you were down underneath.
I don't like that.
Could I go over to this door and just start to explore more of the house?
Absolutely. So, as you guys have the trapdoor opened, Les, you start looking around a little bit further. Crack open that door.
Quietly. Just kind of.
You want to look through it, though?
Yeah.
Yeah? Okay. All right, so. As you open the door, on your left, you see a single door down the hallway, 3 more on your right, 2 immediately, and then another one at the far end of the hall.
Before he goes anywhere, Jules is going to just kind of step out, peeking her head out the door in order to see Margot and Phelan, and then open Awakened Mind and say, "This is the place. Come join us." And then we'll make her way back in.
Quickly, I turn heel and start walking towards the front of the door, beckoning towards Phelan to follow and ordering Galaxy to heal.
Galaxy does not pay attention to you whatsoever. He just continues.
Like, fuck off. Nibbly gave me the order.
Well, if you follow the one who gave you the orders, then I suppose continue to stay out here until otherwise.
So unless you take a couple steps into the hallway.
Yeah, and check out this door here.
Okay. All right. So that door there.
Door sus.
Door opens, and inside you see a 15-foot long dining table. 8 chairs set neatly around it, set with simple silverware and dishes, and a small door stands closed on the far side of the room. That.
So peeking in that room, I'm going to turn around and open this door.
Okay, it's the one directly behind you.
And Nebula would, looking around, would nod towards the door in this room, and looking at Galahad and Jules would... Yeah, you're outside getting their attention. So he would, at Galahad, he would nod towards the door.
Okay. Jules just peeked her head out for like 1 second in order to get eyesight, so then she could activate Awakened Mind and is still there.
Gotcha. Okay. So, Les, you opening that door, taking a peek inside, you see... A wide double bed marks the opposite wall with a pair of simple end tables on either side. As for you guys in the main room, you peeking open that little side door there, you see a simple clothing rack, a couple of hats, a few coats, a few pairs of shoes that are laden inside the room, seeming just like a storage closet of some kind for clothes.
Mm.
Gonna walk into the dining room, just kind of to give a general look around to see if there's just anything that catches my eye before going towards this door.
Okay. So looking around in the dining room, it's a dining hall. One of the things that you're kind of used to from homes, especially the ones that you've seen, is there's usually cooking supplies, cooking locations of some kind. This doesn't have that. It is very much just a dining area. Okay. Taking a look inside this door, you see that the same thing. There don't seem to be any cooking supplies of any real kind, but you see the pantry is well stocked. Small boxes of fresh produce, but there's a slight acrid smell in the air, as if a good amount of the food is spoiled slightly. Looking through the boxes and kind of getting a better view of them even from a distance, you see the fruits and vegetables are almost completely untouched. Signs of mold and mildew. They've definitely been there for some time.
Seeing that, I'm going to kind of come back into the dining room just kind of quickly and get the attention of the others and say, how long ago was it that you saw this Watchmaster again, Valen?
Last time I saw the Watchmaster was last night. Or the last time I saw, I assume, was the Watchmaster was last night.
I just looked in his pantry and it's rotten to the core. You sure it was the Watchmaster you were talking to and not someone pretending to be the Watchmaster?
Do you think humans need food?
Whoever was living here has not touched any of the stores for quite some time and is rotten and old.
Nebula stands up and says, ooh, so we might be onto something. Tobias, dear, and like, because clearly, like, if someone's here, they would have heard us, and starts advancing forward past.
Do it.
Past Les.
Do it.
And says, Tobias, dear, where's your body? Is your body down here? And heads down south to the door down there and is just going to, like, check the handle.
Okay.
Yes, handle divine is... sense.
Cool. The one time you need that shit.
And the handle is not locked.
Cool. He's going to open it up and go, hello. And opens it up. Any dead bodies in here?
So, inside this room.
Okay.
The room is clean and simple. A large bed with a set of cupboard nightstands. Rectangular blue rug lays on the floor with a pair of windows. And a pair of wardrobes fill the corners beside the bed.
And Nebula looks back and goes, probably some stuff to go through in here, but you want to go pick the winning door, please?
Valen. I'm sure it may be locked. You can test your lock picking skills on this one.
I can absolutely try. Probably isn't. And I'll try and open it.
Yeah. Door is not locked.
There you go.
You open it up.
Damn, he's good.
A small blue rug lays on the floor beside a pile of neatly arranged boxes containing official-looking documents. A long wood table is pushed up against the far wall with a chair nearby as pots of ink, quills, and sheets of parchment are spread out upon it. And looking at the parchment, you see plans for buildings of the city. Layouts of streets, homesteads, farms, government buildings, shops, taverns, marked with distances between each.
I'm gonna go through those papers and try and make some sense of it, trying to see what they are trying to mark, what this distance might do. Is this regular architecture, or might this be the Rakshasa trying to figure out their next victim?
Okay. Distances between homes seems a little odd. Go ahead and make a straight intelligence check.
Yeah, I am smart.
Yeesh.
Smart. Oh, no, I am very smart. Fuck. My bad.
I forgot how smart I am. That's how smart I am.
See, but intelligence and wisdom are different.
Yeah, got no wisdom, but, like, he's smart. 15.
15, okay. Yeah, it's definitely odd. Plans for the city, that makes sense, especially for somebody who's in some kind of an engineering part of the city and looking at building new homes. The Watchmaster is not somebody who does that. They're not involved in that side of things at all. You know that given your background. The charts figuring out how far apart homes are, and the general layout of the city seemingly looking for points and areas that seem to have less load-bearing weight put upon them than others is a little on the interesting side. And with the exception of one of the documents seems to outline what is effectively the town square where you were before, with exact measurements from the center of what seems to be this house.
Okay. Shit. I'm still holding on to the theory that this is all under the guise of trying to draw a pentagram underneath the city. However, Liss...
Full Metal Alchemist.
Full Metal Alchemist.
But the thing is, we never checked the rest of the rooms. One of them could very well have led us to the rest of the town hall, and I'll go back out with these papers, show it to the rest of the team. I think we have part of the plans of this demon.
So the one thing that I'll add to that is, because of how much you had explored and the directions that you had gone, the direction that you traveled south into that room where Nebula found the notebook, down that eastern corridor to that door, is the same direction as to the center of where the city is.
Oh no, the truther door. Okay.
Correct.
Okay. This makes a lot of sense then, right? If the door we were supposed to not go through holds the rest of the plans, possibly maybe an altar, maybe where the sacrificers have. Do we think they might have set up explosives underneath there and trying to take down the town hall? Toll celebration?
Him saying those words just sparked something in my mind from a previous encounter I had with demons from an adventure long time ago.
Yeah.
Wait, you saying, did you just say that behind that scary door leads to probably the center of town where many, many people were, where demons may like to sacrifice said people, and there's a bunch of them outside right now ready to be taken?
When you put it that way, it sounds...
It's like lambs to a slaughter.
I think if we want to not have a ton of people die very immediately, we might want to evacuate that area post-haste. I think that might happen any time now. It's perfect. There's tons of people down for the festival. There's more arriving. If anything's going to happen, it's probably going to happen very, very soon.
I think that we need to evacuate them, but I think we need to make it look like not an evacuation.
How do you do that? You got some crazy carnival game in the back of your head that's like, hey, everyone, let's play get the fuck away from this area.
Oh, yeah. What do you think it's going to do to evacuate the people without harming them? Set the booths on fire?
I don't know. You can always shoot them in the back of the head, Margo.
We could set the booths on fire. That might be... that would make more people rush there.
I might have a bit of an answer for that.
The way that Corsa said that scared me. I'm sorry. And what would that be?
Well, we need something to gather them all. And admittedly, when need be, I have a certain way with people. And perhaps we... let me talk from that stage, and I could clear the whole place out. Ideally, I could clear it for a while if all goes according to plan.
So beyond those fancy words, what is your plan? What are you going to tell them?
Just say it simply.
They need a reason to gather elsewhere and to move about.
Mm-hmm.
This is a festival. This town is here and very jovial. They're about their people.
The point, Nebula. The point.
Someone's gone missing. Boy has gone missing on the outskirts of town, and your uncle is requesting the help of the people. And at this moment, he looks Jules in the eyes, and while Jules is not a commoner, will still at the very least see the heart of darkness, and commoners are compelled to help me if they experience this, and they will draw up arms to fight alongside me if I'm ever in a fight by myself. And so trying to pair that with the fact that I'm in someone important in this town's, like, visage.
I don't...
Yeah.
Listen, by the way the people were running around, it's not like this face is really having any trouble making a bad name for itself, okay?
Okay. It's the thing, I can't think of any other way other than scaring people out of there. We can all do some, I guess, non-lethal damage and just, like, maybe shoot some fireworks or something into the air and terrify people, but whatever we do, people will think is a celebration. If this sounds like...
We need to get them away. We need to ruin the time for them. We can't have them come back once the dust is all settled. We need to destroy something to keep them away.
We get them out and then we... I turn around to Margot and say, let the dragon do her thing.
Austin.
Well, Arson. We're definitely going to need you to do that because getting them out is only part of it. Whatever this is, we'll still be set and ready to go if a different group were to gather.
I have to destroy people's festival, it appears. It's not the first time I've done that, I suppose. Maybe. May not be my last, but it's not out of my capabilities.
We'll call it a team-building exercise, everyone.
It's the biggest bonfire you'll ever be at.
As, like, it's always sunny in Philadelphia, music comes up to, like, black with white.
The party goes camping.
Goes to a festival.
Just as a reminder, then, for everyone, we are about to go to a pretty hefty fight, then. If this creature can cast all of these spells on the door and not even worry about it, we might want to be a tip-top shape. Try and keep to your disposables if you can. But, all right, Nebula, we will wait for your signal once you get out. Margot can start the raising and will help.
I don't like this idea.
Yeah. Couldn't we do something a little less destructive considering that we are all acting Crown's Guard and we do have official badges and everything?
I'm not doing anything destructive at all. I'm simply removing people from the area to go assist in the search and rescue of a poor little
boy. But you're using the image of my uncle. My issue is more with even if we handle this situation and we walk out, if according to my uncle, I'm quote unquote in the negative when it comes to dealing with this issue, if I've done more harm than good, then I'm...
Right, back to square one.
Exactly.
What if then we use, instead of your uncle's image, we use the
Watchmaster
image?
The only problem there, and he transforms into the Watchmaster, but speaks in Nebula's voice, I don't know what the guy sounds like.
I've heard it, but I can't not imitate it.
So, at this moment, as you all are inside the house talking...
Oh god, no.
You start to hear heavy footfalls from the exterior.
Oh god, no.
Has Galaxy told me anything?
Galaxy, as the footfalls are rounding one of the corners, you start to hear... God's coming. Looking angry.
Seems we're having some company. Guards are on the way.
One guy with a scar on his face.
Washburn.
And Nebula transforms back into the uncle.
Okay.
And
we maybe hop down the trap door and cover it back up again.
Oh god. Okay.
Yeah, just like Nebula and I can handle this. Go.
And yeah, they usher for the rest of you to go down the go down the way.
Okay.
So we're going down the trap door.
We're going down the trap door.
Where all the fire could kill us?
Alright, so yeah.
Exactly,
you,
yep.
All four of you, we're gonna slide you, whoops, down into second area. So, hopping onto the ladder, heading down into the familiar space underground, Nebula and Jules, what are you guys doing?
Jules is gonna, like, turn facing away from the door and just kind of call out, Tobias! Watchmaster Tobias!
Sorry, hold on. One thing that Nebula would have
actually
specifically asked Galahad to not go.
Okay.
Oh, Galahad was the one who punched the door, and if anyone told someone, he wants the metal man to be seen here at this moment.
Okay. Cool, yeah.
I like your funny words, magic man.
Yeah, Jules is just calling out Tobias's name, and then as she hears the footsteps like enter the door, she'll turn to Zacharias Fowler and say, Uncle, I don't think he's here.
And Les was going to say something right before we switch.
Sorry.
No, it's okay. It's just, I want to see, again, I want to ask Jordy if this is possible, because I want to take a precaution in case these flame things are activated while we're down here. Can I do Wall of Water in a ring around us, giving us like a protective cylinder of H2O from the flaming stands around us?
Up to 30 feet long, 10 feet high, 1 foot thick. You can make a ringed wall up to 20 feet in diameter. Yep.
Legend.
Just a precaution.
Yeah, you can absolutely do that. So it lasts for a minute, I think. 10 minutes. So yeah, more than enough time. So it's up to 20 feet. So you guys are easily able to huddle in like a small area where less you create like an oval shaped wall of water, essentially, that's 10 feet high, way above where the braziers were, a foot thick, and you feel like it might definitely do something to try and abate some of the damage in the area underneath. So for everybody who's watching on Twitch, this is where everybody else is inside this area that they know about. But all the doors now are closed and relocked, and in comparison to what you had seen yesterday, all the tables that you had moved in there to cover off the braziers, all of those pieces have been removed, and the room is back to its familiar setting as it was before.
Heat.
So. Where did all this go? There we go. So. Jumping back to the house. As the three of you are inside, are you recovering the trapdoor?
With the carpet, yes.
Okay. All right. So you very quickly take that carpet, recover it up the trapdoor. And outside.
And Nebula, it has an action held for the moment that Galaxy says that this guy with the scar on the face approaches the door.
Okay.
I'm just going to act as the bodyguard and just silently be behind his shoulder the whole time.
All right, so Nebula, you're going back into the main chamber?
Yeah, Nebula is going to sit on the couch.
Okay. All right. So, with you guys in that main area, a voice starts to ring out from outside. You who are in my house, what gives you the right to be in there?
As Zacharias Fowler, I'll head for the door. Okay. But my held action is I have divine sense up. As soon as I step out.
It's good.
So
Jules will let her face light up and go, "Oh, you're exactly who we were looking for."
So, stepping into the doorway, you see the described and face that was created via the illusionary magic from Phelan earlier of Tobias Pettersson, and a series of heavy footfalls flanking on either side as several, probably close to a dozen guards begin to flank in and around behind him at the broken open door as the man himself steps up and into the doorway. And Zacharias.
That moment of divine sense going up right now.
Okay. So with that moment of divine sense going up, a second. Celestial fiend around it within 60 feet of you. you recognize a fiend standing 10 feet in front of you.
Excellent.
Don't do it.
And that Joel's is going to be where we take our break. So we're going to give ourselves 10 minutes to grab a little bit of water. We're going to come back to this one very quick. I promise you guys, I don't want to take you all away from this because it is too good. But this is
about to go down.
This is
but we're down in goddamn trapdoor room. How are we going to join the fight?
You have a ladder that is down. You're 35 feet down, and you're able to reclimb up the ladder if you so choose.
Okay, good.
But
okay.
Yeah, so with that, we're going to be back in about 10 minutes or so, guys. Stick around. Definitely won't want to miss this one. But yeah, we'll see you guys back here real soon.
It's going down.
And we're back. So, with the group, half of them currently descended down a ladder 35 feet down into the underground cavern below, and the rest of them up top, now being confronted by Watchmaster Tobias Pedersen and seemingly being flanked by at least a dozen armed Crown's Guard.
Let's do this, homie.
What would you all like to do?
Murder.
Jules kind of smiles. It's like, you're just the person we were looking for, and we'll open awakened mind to Nebula. Just be like, just like, yeah, I've got this open.
And Nebula thinks too in his mind. Excellent. Ah, Tobias, I must say, I'm not a huge fan of having to wait. You know that, don't you?
He just kind of takes a look at you, and you can see the eyes narrow a little bit. Why did you come to my house, friend?
Hector and Daxus. I've been waiting on answers. I've been waiting on results. And yet here we are still having a lovely festival, and I am still unaware. I still have no answers, Tobias.
You can see him kind of look off at this Crown's Guard beside him and look behind you at Galahad and at Nebula. Or sorry, and Jesus, what the hell? How did you and
Jules
switch places? Sorry. Jules and Galahad, and just,
this isn't exactly the best time or place, friend. Is there somewhere else perhaps we could speak when I have a door again?
Well, we can take care of that. It's no issue.
I would like to look slightly guilty.
You see him just kind of look back at you as you just kind of like sheepishly like kick the ground a little and just...
It's quite challenging to enjoy festivities when you've got such morbid thoughts as some of your men being missing on the mind.
For what it's worth, you're not exactly alone in that. One of my men didn't show up for work today, either.
Hmm. Would that be exactly?
Who might that be?
It is of no concern. I'm sure that we'll find him soon. Probably drunk, laid up in a bed somewhere.
With all due respect, but it would be somewhat of concern to me. I've been sent by the rest of the family here to help my dear uncle solve this issue. It needs to be dealt with post haste, and if you can't get the job done, then I'm afraid that I will.
I'm sure I've told you before, the family gets a little testy when things don't quite go our way, and unfortunately more and more will just keep showing up. So, I would like to be unbothered much sooner. So perhaps the dining hall.
Lead the way. You stay outside. Keep him watch out.
And
he starts to step inside and do you mind? And he looks over at you, Galahad, and kind of looks at the door broken on the ground.
I'll pick up the door and look around a little sheepishly. Is he implying I put it back on the hinge?
Yeah.
I'll give it a try.
Yeah, as you go to do that, Jules will awaken mine to Galahad, just like, stay out here, keep an eye on the guards, keep an eye on that trap door.
Understood.
Okay. So
sort of look at some of the crown's guard as I'm trying to get the door in, like, is that okay?
He's like cantilevered in. You can see them just kind of like looking at you and like hands on swords, hands on spears, definitely more prepared than some of the ones that you've seen in the past. But regardless, Tobias steps inside.
Lead the way, friend.
And by Zachariah turns and goes to lead him into the hallway.
And Jules will kind of gesture with her hand for Tobias to follow next, as to flank this dude.
So he begins to make his way inside.
And Galahad's repaired the door
as best he can.
It's
on its hinges vaguely again, but that's about all you can expect. So Tobias is going to make his way across, start to follow you into the dining hall.
Jules will follow behind him.
Okay.
Yeah, and we'll head...
And he sits at the center of the opposite side of the table.
As we're entering, though, because we have Awakened Mind open, right?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
How... This carpet, how big is it? And you said when we opened it, it was silent, right?
So the carpet was not silent. The hinge was silent.
I have to be able to see someone in order to open Awakened Mind, and I can only do one person at a time.
No, yeah, but you had this open with me. And as we were leaving, I would have awakened right back to you before I entered the hallway and said, open the hatch when we're out of sight. And then verbally said, make sure you do a better door. Make sure you do a better door repair there. And then we'll come by and we'll officially handle it. And then said out loud to Galahad, like, fix that.
So you can see that as you're starting to make your way through and saying that, that Tobias is waiting at the door for all of you. You to lead the way, Nebula, but everybody else to follow behind.
And Nebula is going to say, or sorry, go ahead, Jules, you were talking.
No, you go first.
Nebula is going to look at him and say, come, I don't like to be kept waiting, and I need a wisdom save as command is used.
Okay. So for command, you cast the spell command. Nothing seems to happen.
Ain't no way. Ain't no fucking way.
So, yeah, I say, come. And
he just looks back at you and he just goes, once your friends join us. And he looks directly at Jules and Galahad in the opposite room.
Would you like our guard to join us in this conversation? That seems unnecessary. I thought that this was going to be private.
And he looks up at Galahad and... I don't like people being in my home without my eyes on them.
Your
he can
guards
guard
are there.
You from inside the other room.
Will you say that again? I missed it. Sorry.
He can guard you from inside the other room.
So be it. Come along.
He gestures now, for the two of you to follow.
Did I note anything happen when I cast command and nothing seems to come of it? Like, was there any action or anything at all?
No, you seem to be able to cast the spell. You designated a target, but just cool. He didn't seem to respond in any way to it.
Cool. Nebula notes that.
Yeah.
So, leading the way into the other room, all three of you. So the trapdoor is still currently covered by the rug. There's no way mm-hmm. that he's letting you uncover it or anything like that. But
Jules will attempt to be the last one through the door to leave.
That's fine. He'll let people walk past him, but...
She wants him to go first and to follow behind him.
That's fine. He'll lead the way. And eventually get all of you into the other room.
Jules will awaken mind a nebula and say, do you still want me to open the door?
Not much choice else.
Okay. So as he like gets out of sight and he can't see the room behind us through the hallway, Jules will let him go as far as he can without it being super suspicious, and she will cast Mage Hand and flip the rug up and open the trap door and continue to walk as though like nothing happened.
Okay. So first off, sleight of hand check.
All right.
To try and cast Mage Hand without being seen.
I'm giving you the Phelan's Grip.
That is a 19 plus 2, so a 21. Thank you so much, Moose.
Okay. So you cast Mage Hand as he looks out of sight just a second to make sure that Galahad and Nebula, disguised as Zacharias, begin to make their way through the door, and you go to lift up the rug, and the rug weighs much more than 5 feet. Much more than 5 pounds. The hand is unable to lift it.
Ooh.
Damn, probably closer to about 25 rug. To 30 pounds.
What?
Okay.
Yeah, dude, have you ever tried to lift a 15-foot square rug? It's a heavy motherfucker just to lift a corner of that.
Yeah. Way. Yeah, you're right.
I don't know what a 15-foot means.
Yeah, Jules will kind of...
to be like 6 meters.
Ooh. Oh my god.
Yeah. Jules will awaken mind to Nebula again, cursing in Infernal. Saying it's too heavy, the rug's too heavy.
But
understood.
Those of you down below, a little bit of crackling fire, unless you had cast Wall of Water to kind of silence that a little bit. The water makes no sound whatsoever. It's essentially just in place and almost diluting some of the sound of the fire. You do hear some of the footsteps walking away from the trapdoor.
Okay, so. We are stuck here. Do we... They said they can handle it up there. Do we try and open one of those doors? The one that we know leads to where everything is at?
I think I have a solution. And I cast Message. Because... you can cast a spell through solid objects if you're familiar with the target and know it is beyond the barrier.
Absolutely. Who are you messaging?
I'm gonna head up and be like, Jules, you there?
Oh no.
So Jules, you have awakened mind and message that you're responding to. Let me close this conversation. Let me close this conversation.
Hold on, I got another call coming in. Oh god, that's a headache. Oh,
oh no, we've gone cross-eyed.
You open message with Jules and she's just like, Marco? Marco? Shut up.
Shame.
Whisper. I can hear your whispers. Are you leaving? What do you want us to do?
Come up. Come up and join us.
Okay.
Then I will. And at that point, Margot will be the last one to leave the room, but she'll tell the other two to go up.
Before we do, Do we all remember that the Watchmaster knows that you all were with me? So us going up there, any pretense is going to be broken. He knows that a warforged, a tiefling, a dragonborn, and a changeling were with me. And Les Paul. Fuck, I forgot. I was like, and the DM. I was like, shit, fuck.
Right. But so you want to try to explore down here a little bit before needing to go up there first?
No, I mean, if they're up there, odds are they'll probably already know. Margo, are you able to just tell them to be prepared for an ambush?
Do you think this is going to end as badly as it can be?
I mean, if I were the creature...
Rather, why don't I just ask Jules? So I'll ask Jules, what can we expect when we come up?
How many guards? About a dozen guards?
About a dozen, all stationed outside. Currently, the only person inside with you is Tobias.
Okay, yeah. Jules will say there's roughly a dozen guards stationed outside of the building currently. Tobias, Nebula, me, and Galahad are making our way to the dining room right now. The door is back on the thing, right?
The door is back on its hinges. It can be taken off pretty easily. There's nothing really holding it in place.
But it's blocking the visual
sight. It's blocking visual sight, correct.
Got it.
And you do remember that there are no windows inside that main room.
Did Nebula say anything about being a fiend to anybody?
No.
He didn't say it out loud.
No,
yes, because he couldn't respond to Jules, and you couldn't awaken mind it to Jules.
Yeah.
He couldn't awaken a mind into Jules.
I mean, that is the whole reason I used awakened mind. But anyway,
thanks. He didn't do that yet. Wow, you're so keen about covering your bases, and you couldn't tell us what we're fucking dealing with. So, thanks.
Well, so as we go up there, Margo
Jules will just inform Margo of the situation and be like, you guys can come up without any issue.
Okay. I'm going to relay what Phelan said, though, about him knowing that they can expect half of our party.
He won't be able to see you from where he's at currently.
You think he's prepared for us in any way, even if we're not around?
I don't know, but last fight, you hit Les Paul in the back of the head with a fireball because we ended up being bottlenecked. And right now...
You're never going to let me live that down. Is now the time to talk about this?
Yes, always.
That trapdoor is quite the bottleneck.
Better out in the open, I suppose. It's better than being shoved down here in a brazier.
Damn, we got to pull a Shrek.
Better out than in, I always say.
Sorry, Jordy, outside the living room, there's no windows that the guards can see inside the house, is there?
Correct. The only way visibility
out of the trapdoor, they're like, what the fuck?
Yeah, as far as you're aware, Jules has told you that all the guards are currently stationed outside. The door is back on its hinges, so the one viewpoint into that main chamber from the exterior is blocked.
Okay, cool. Let's just fucking go up there.
I'm going to tell them, go up, be quiet. They can't see us, and we don't want them to see us.
Okay. So who's going up first?
I'll go ahead so I can push open the fucking heavy-ass rug.
Okay. So you climb your way up to the top, 35 feet up without any real issue. Go ahead and make a strength check for me to try and lift the trapdoor that's covered by the rug.
Could I assist him?
I will say
you're standing on a 5-foot wide ladder. There is no ability to assist.
I push up his leg.
Also have powerful build as a bugbear, which means I count as large when determining my carrying capacity, as well as the weight I can push, drag, or lift.
Okay, so you'll be able to make that an advantage.
Cool. My strength
Chewbacca.
Is plus zero.
Ah-ha-ha.
It's also going to drop the DC because of that.
Okay. Let's see.
Let's do
Thank
it.
God for that advantage. Went from a 9 to an 18.
Yeah, 18 is more than enough. So you just kind of getting up there and your frame already being sized, you know, a little bit of a size above most of the others. You kind of see Lesson behind is like, oh, can I help out with that? And you just... And you silently, but you can hear the rug being dragged across the floor a little bit as it does open up and you are able to kind of fold it over onto itself. Still covered by the rug a little bit, but you can lift it up as a flap and be able to look out into the chamber now.
Silent but deadly.
Literally.
That's my logo. That's my motto.
That's your t-shirt.
I'm going to be the last one to climb up because I'm going to keep the mental message going with Jules.
Okay.
I'll no, you move hang the up rug first. As quietly as I can to make sure that there's enough space for us to crawl out.
Okay. So you three starting to make your way into that chamber. So we're going to jump back to the other three of you now in the room. And you can see that Tobias is seated on one side of the table and he gestures to the three chairs on the opposite side. You wanted to have a conversation. We're here.
I suppose you wouldn't want anyone listening in on our dealings, then?
That would be a safe bet. And he
then
gets up
allow
and he,
me.
He makes his way over to the window, and he just pulls down a blackened blind to cover the one window that's in the wall.
And Zacharias starts making some ceilings. No need for anyone else to be listening in, and he begins to cast a spell.
Okay.
And he casts protection from good and evil on himself.
Okay. Okay, good to know.
And he looks over to Jules and gives the nod, because I assume we're still open, or have you shut that because we, like, we're back and forth?
I shut... I think that there's no rule in the game that I have to shut it, but I think that it makes sense to shut it, because mental capacities and stuff. But as soon as Jules is done with Margo, since Margo can open that back up at will, Jules will open it back up with you, since you can't, Will.
And he'll say out loud, I assume you don't mind me managing my own affairs, and in his mind has warned, this is the creature we've been looking for.
Curses and infernal.
So as you think that to Jules.
Grumble, 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 grumble.
You hear creature.
And I
creature,
look immediately.
Fuck.
Are you referring to exactly?
And I look immediately over and I said, I'll get to you in a moment, my friend.
Oh, I don't believe
curses
we're
and
friends.
Infernal again.
You may as well say it out loud. I can hear it all anyway.
When I have noted in my...
Moe's nice delayed reaction.
No, he can probably hear the message. That's what I'm fucking stressed about.
Oh, yeah.
Telepathy.
He saw the AB conversation. He saw his way into it. He's... That... Yeah, no, he...
There's an eighth member of this call. It's the fucking...
And Nebula will turn back and look at Watchmaster Tobias here and say, well, you have to understand, with the missing members of my team, business was being affected. I certainly had to look into it. And, well, I'm certainly fiending for an answer.
You had to look into your business. You had to look into your business. I'm sure. You, I believe, and he looks over at you, Jules. That is the face and stature of a Fowler. That is not. What are you exactly?
Your worst nightmare.
I'm definitely...
Nebula at that will look at the person and say, well, I suppose birds of a feather, and transforms into the Watchmaster.
And the Watchmaster just goes,
Oh. A changeling. Interesting.
I take it you're a Rakshasa then. I've heard a lot about you.
You see him just kind of ruffle his face a little bit, as if kind of shaking some water off of his face, and his face just reverts into a tiger's guise as he sits across the table from you, hands reversed upside down, essentially, all of his fingers kind of splayed upwards and closing the fists up on top of his hands.
You may as well invite your friends up as well. I'm sure that they should be a part of this conversation. And you do want to leave this room alive, I assume.
Jules will switch over, I guess, to message.
Well, we're already up.
Yeah, you're already up, but you haven't come in, though.
I mean, you could just say,
"That's
Jake's
true."
Up.
I'll just say out loud. Margo, come on in. Come on in here.
Well, fellas, I think the jig is up.
Kind of been there.
Wait, does he know that we're all here, or just that you are here?
Well, the fact that Jules beckoned me, of all people, with my temper and impulse control issues, I highly doubt this is a good situation.
Yeah, no, we have no other option. So walk to the
room. To enter the danger room, lads.
Highway to
danger zone.
So I'll get you all to arrange yourselves in the room as you would like to be.
If my token was there.
The guise of Tobias Pedersen replaced by that
Tiger, Inside Out Tiger, or whatever. God,
Tiger Flame.
Poiga.
Don't you look at that. A target.
So, as the individual reveals themselves to you, you see a similar scar. Again, from just below the eye, going back towards the cheek, as if the scar was the one thing that could not be replaced in the disguise self spell, or maybe a choice to maintain the scar upon the face. But the skin having turned into ashy gray, black, and dark red fur, you see a fairly long mane coming down the back of the neck, the clothes kind of transitioning into more loose-fitting robes. Dark, deep reds and familiar insignias of demonic entities and open skulls coming off of the wings of the off of the shoulders and down the arms. And you see a series of tattoos all down the forearms and across the hands and across the knuckles as well. And Jules, you recognize a few of these as infernal symbols. And on each of the knuckles, with the exception of one, are the current lords of all the hells.
He tight with him, aye.
So.
Oh, the fancy lad.
You break into my home. Come down into my sanctum below. I assume you are the ones who decided to have your way with my pets last evening. What do I call you?
Oh, I haven't really thought of a band name yet. Have we done that yet? Have we thought of a name?
No.
And Nebula looks forward at the creature and says, you know, I've got to say, you could call us Interested Parties. You could call us Curious. And he'll reach over for his bag of holding. And he'll open that up and he'll reach in and he'll fish out the copy of the, because we still have the copy of the thing that we whittled downstairs, right?
Yeah, you do.
And so he'll pull that out and he'll go, we are collectors, a little bit of woodworkers maybe, I guess more stone here, and he'll put it down on the table. But there's really nothing like the real thing, I hear.
You would be quite correct.
And he just kind of reaches, and you can see, like, part of his shoulder. He actually just tears the fur off of part of his shoulder and reaches into the shoulder itself and just pulls out a seven-sided crystal about 4 inches long or so. Same depth, same size as what you would expect. And the wound itself, he just kind of pushes back over itself and the blood matting on the fur, but seemingly a part of himself that he's ripped out, and places it on the table in front of him.
So, is this the part where you tell us your evil plan and that there's no way we can stop you, or that you're going to probably attempt to kill a lot of people? I've heard a lot of these talks, I have to admit.
No. You're welcome to stop me. You're welcome to die doing so, if you would like to try. But I have the weight of the entire military and Crown's Guard behind me. You are 6 people. You have no clue what my plans are. You don't even know if I have a plan. I think that is fairly obvious given the fact that you broke into my home in broad daylight. Take a look downstairs again at a place that you've already been. And with your friend back there, and he gestures toward Phelan, having told me who you are, what you saw, I know that you have no idea, and I have no interest in explaining it to you. But I also have no interest in being interrupted. So this is a choice for you. Your group is welcome to leave this place, leave this city, leave me to my dealings. Walk away, wash your hands of this unpleasantness, and come back when I have vacated my position. Should you stay, you'll simply be added to the pile.
And Nebula is going to look over at Jules and nod.
She'll open awakened mind.
And in Sylvan, he's going to say, what do you think?
So, clarification here. Awakened mind, I don't believe you use language. I believe it is telepathy, which is just thoughts.
Awakened mind. You don't need to share language.
So it is just thoughts. So even speaking in Sylvan, it doesn't translate.
So he nods, and Jules opens up. And then if he considers that, then he'll just openly speak the words in Sylvan. Mm-hmm. What do you think out loud? He says it in Sylvan. And then he'll look at the creature and say, in Sylvan, is this really the best course of action?
And you see him just look back at you.
Jordan, you said that he put something down in front of him earlier. It was like a tuft of fur or something.
No, it was the seven-sided crystal that fit into that hole that Phelan tried
out of his arm.
Yeah, it was literally embedded under his flesh. So it's that crystal that would allow you to gain access to whatever that room was that Phelan tried to get into, that knocked you all unconscious under the sleep spell.
And I have a DM question for you.
Yes.
How fast is my sonic ability to telekinetically grab that thing from where it is right now?
It's an instantaneous effect. It's not teleportation. You see it moving.
If I wanted to swipe that thing, I'm just trying to gauge, like, is it, like, going, like, would it be fast enough for him to snatch it, or is it fast enough that I could go and just grab it super fast, is what I'm trying to gauge.
Well, it's an action to complete it, so it would use the amount of time an action would take on your turn, 6 seconds.
And theoretically, he'd be able to have a reaction to see if he could grab it, possibly?
Correct. Okay. Theoretically. We're not in combat, so there's not any real, like, you know, definitive things on that. But regardless of that, regardless of the amount of time that it takes, it's not something where it's there, it's gone, and you're holding it, and nobody could see it.
Yeah.
He would see it move to you. That you
of course,
sure.
I know that. Yeah. I'm just more judging by the speed of which it would come.
Yeah, we'll say that it's something that would be fast enough that he could make a check to try and grab it, but there's a possibility that that check would not be high enough. Essentially, he'd be rolling a dex check against your spell save DC.
Okay.
All right, so Nebula has spoken in Sylvan and didn't get a response, and he'll one more time say, and what if we don't want to leave in Sylvan? Are you still going to add us to the pile?
He just looks back at you. And you can see that he doesn't seem to be reacting to the words you're speaking. He's more reacting to the thought process of forming the words. If you don't leave, obviously it depends on where you are exactly. But you may end up on the pile.
Phelan straightens up his back a bit and turns to say, so here's the thing. Threats are all nice and dandy and killing. Death is a very great threat to those who fear it. But to those who have nothing to lose and all of it to gain, you might want to reconsider other options. And I don't think any of us have anything to lose here for you right now. So what I say is,
my friend, you have no idea what you can
have
lose. You believe that this body
you are handling with.
You believe that this body ties you to this plane. You believe that when you die, your body rests in the ground, peaceful, blissful. Ignorance is what you have. Believe me when I say that the names you found in that journal, which I assume you have, are not resting peacefully. They will never rest again. Their souls bound in eternal damnation to my masters in the hells below.
Yeah, Nebula's fucking done. Nebula looks around at the party and just looks to see if there's anything that anyone in this instance does or says. And
at this, yep, at and, this point, yeah.
And yep, we're gonna with my telekinetic movement.
As he looks around, sorry, go ahead, I see some hands.
I was just gonna say, the minute anything about Bladevein being gone, game over. Margo's ready to fight.
Okay.
Yeah.
So triggers a less you telekinetic movement the stone to your hand. Margo's game, Nebula.
So Nebula's about to do something, but it's sort of a sneaky thing. But I guess if Les's thing triggers first, that might trigger a.
So let's see, Galahad, what did you want to do?
This is a while ago, but it's fine. We'll do it now. When he starts talking about the souls and all that stuff, I'm just going to sort of tense up and I'm going to grip my hilt and I'm going to cast Magic Weapon.
Okay.
Yeah, as he's talking about the souls, Jules subconsciously like casts Thaumaturgy and her eyes start to wisp the fowler spectral green.
So oil. In that case, Nebula and Les, I'll get you guys to both roll initiative checks to determine who goes first in your action.
Okay. Trust the die.
Can I lob a fireball at this rock?
Ball?
Ball or bolt?
Fireball
in the room that the entire fireball will fill.
I got a 21.
Oof. 16.
16. Okay, so Nebula.
All right, I suppose first. I can just do a firebolt.
Preferably at the enemy.
So, Nebula, what did you want to do?
And so
Nebula, where are you again on the map? Just making sure, Les.
No. Nebula in Sylvan thinks and says,
come now. And telepathically has said that to Galaxy, but has also audibly said it in the same language with the same moment, okay. And says, come now, my friend, as he continues in Sylvan.
Okay, so.
Why?
Let's just double check.
Be so hostile.
Up to 40 feet to an unoccupied space it can see.
And so with that, we are dealing with, there's a window to the side, right?
Correct. That is currently blacked out, shade drawn.
And so Nebula would understand this.
Yeah.
And Nebula is said, come now, my friend. And he's going to stand up from the table. And okay. He's going to move over towards... Was that just a window?
Yeah, just a window with a black shade that's been pulled down over it.
Cool. All right, so I'm going to fucking check movement on this, because okay. I can move through two mazes. That's 10 feet over to the window?
Yeah.
Or is that 15?
No, it's 10 feet.
So he's going to walk over to the window as he says, come now, my friend. Why being so hostile? And he's got his bag in hand. Mm-hmm. He like stood up with it. Mm-hmm. And he... touches the black shade and is going to peel it back. When it's such a beautiful day, and when he peels back this, the idea here is hopefully that Galaxy can see through.
Mm-hmm. And teleport into the room.
Teleport into the room.
Okay.
Is that line of sight possible here? Because I have like a very particular thing I'm trying. It's cool if it fails.
Given where he currently is, if you delay your movement to like a very slow pace and you're like instinctively telling him, see, yeah, that's the thing is given where he is, he doesn't see that. So he would need more specific instructions as to where the window is. Yeah. So it's a good idea in theory, and it would work if he was there or if you were able to tell him to get to that point. But with the instructions that you've given him, he hears come now, my friend, and understands that you want him to come there, but doesn't know how. So you would get a response, because you can communicate telepathically, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, so you would get a response. Actually, let me double check. Find Steed.
This is so intense.
You can communicate with it telepathically. Yeah, it cannot respond to you. Actually, let me double check. Find cheat.
I think it can.
Respond. Responds 5e. Can a fine steed sourced mount actually respond? This has been established via the player's handbook errata. In the next paragraph, communicate with is now communicate with each other. Yes, so you can. So it can respond to you and go, how? So, but as you do that, you walk over and you open up the window and you say that less... That then triggers yours of snatching that. So what is your spell save DC?
So here's the thing.
Yeah.
I'm not sure what my spell casting modifier is because I'm a fighter, but because my other abilities are based off intelligence, that's what I was going to ask you. Is it based off that?
Well, so that's the whole thing with Psy Warrior. Psy Warrior should have a spell.
Okay.
It should specifically say.
If it's 8 plus spell casting modifier plus proficiency, it's 8 plus 6, so 14.
14, okay. So he's got a 14 dex check to be able to try and grab that out of the air. And that is a natural 18 plus 3. Yeah, so he's totally fine. So you reach out for it and you just like make the motion to grab it. From, you know, like a good 15 feet away behind him, and he just kind of like looks over his shoulder at you and sees it begin to move ever so slightly and start to accelerate, and he just reaches out and it accelerates right into his hand, and he's now holding it
and
just refusing to let it go.
Would like to use that very moment, because I haven't done an action, I moved.
Mm-hmm.
I would like to use that very moment to take this action then, as I have thought, hurry.
Mm-hmm.
And I would like to use my action to bolt at the Rakshasa.
Okay.
And so yeah, I'm going to move up to it as it reacts and catches that.
Mm-hmm.
And how big is it? It's humanoid, right?
It is humanoid. It is not considered a large creature. It's similar size to you, maybe a little bit taller, about 6'1", 6'2".
Cool.
I would like to, with my open bag of holding I have, sack it over its head. It's a Murder? Five by it's
yeah,
a
yeah, I know.
You're gonna try to snuff the Rakshasa?
No bleeding.
It's a good thing the crab's not in there anymore. You can just stick the crab on the Rakshasa's head from inside the bag of holding.
Okay, so strictly speaking, the rules are silent on a targeted shove. So you can make the attack action to make a special melee attack of a grapple. And then you can attempt to force move a grappled creature. Using the attack action, you can make a special melee attack to shove a creature.
So yeah, I'm just trying to take my open bag and...
Yeah, but that's the thing, is he's able to resist that. So what this is going to be is we're going to make this a contested athletics check. So you're going to be rolling athletics against his athletics or acrobatics.
I feel like against a cat, this may end horribly.
Okay. So, all right, I'm going to make athletics. I saw cat.
You got to win to push him into the bag.
Okay. So that is a 22.
Okay. So I have a +5 to whatever this is. Come on. No, hold on. That's not Nebula's die. I need to roll with Nebula's die.
If you want to, you did also get a D4 of inspiration.
I saw that. Yeah. All right. So. Oh. Mm-mm. That one's not going to fly. Doesn't matter if I add that to it. It's not going to fly. And I don't think I have anything. I did it in the moment he was attacked, but I don't know.
All right, so you take the bag of holding, you open it up, and you attempt to put it over his head, and he just grabs it with one furry backwards hand and, like, reaches back onto your hand and just rips it and pulls it back up over his head and just... Now that is not appreciated. You, and he touches you on the side of the head, go wait outside. I need you to make a...
I'm sorry, is this charmed, frightened, or anything? Because I got protection from good and evil, baby! Can't be!
Creatures that can't be charmed are immune to this effect.
Oh! Can't touch me!
Wait and touch you. Okay.
So he reaches out and touches you, and just, go wait outside.
And moment, may I pop off?
Yeah. So,
okay.
Pop off.
What would you like to do?
I'm going to bonus action expend a first level spell slot to cast Hex upon him, and then I'm going to use my action in order to fire two Eldritch Blasts right into this motherfucker's face.
Okay.
It's going down.
So, as you go to cast Hex, and you see him having just reached out and just placed a finger, go wait outside, and touch the side of Nebula's head, and Nebula, fully resisting to the effect, just kind of smiles back at him a little bit, and you just reach out and go to cast Hex on him, and you see that the spell gets cast, gets released from your hand, and he just reaches up and just goes, and it just vanishes in midair, and then your two Eldritch Blasts, you reach back and boom, boom, and you impact those, and they just boom, boom, fall off of him with no effect whatsoever.
Cool.
My I still pick. Expended that spell slot, correct?
You did expend that spell slot. So at this point, we are rolling initiative. We are now officially in combat.
Do we still keep our initiatives that we rolled?
No, you don't.
Okay.
Because now it's actual initiative. So
okay.
Let's go into combat here.
Oh, damn!
We don't know what the Everybody's fuck this motherfucker called.
Tried to do spells at him, and they just melted.
Starfield on steroids.
Let's do
Starfield
it.
Starfield on steroids.
I got an 18.
I got a 30-20.
Natural 20! Whoa!
I got a 9.
+3. Holy shit, that never happens with me.
No, wait, that's actually not a 9. That's a 6.
That's a 6. Look for the dot. So.
Actually, with my initiative, that's only a 7. I got a 7.
So, initiative.
Fuck yeah, baby!
Let's turn that down just a little so it's not blowing your
remember
drums.
everybody has inspiration.
Everybody do.
And Jordy, I
need have to know, I have two inspirations.
He just stopped me, or did he like attack and tear the bag or scratch me or anything in the same process?
Nope, he stopped the bag. He was so your attack on your turn was unsuccessful essentially, and then he reached out as an action on his turn and boom, tried to boop you.
Cool.
And that no longer went into effect. So initiatives 25 to 20.
22 for me, dog.
Okay, Les Paul, 22. Jules, 20.
That's the best initiative I've ever rolled. I'm just so bad at it.
15 to 20?
18.
18.
20. Yeah!
I got a plus 4 on my
dex. So dex. Do I.
Okay, let's roll. You know what? We can...
No, you guys get to decide on each turn who goes first. So that's the good thing there.
Cool.
Margo?
7.
Okay, and Galahad?
It was 20 plus 0.
Oh, you're 20. Nice.
Oh, so, you got a 20 as well.
Holy shit!
Jesus.
It's illegal.
Well, he got a 19 and is going fourth. So,
we're finally coming together as a team, gang.
So, top of the round, Les Paul, you are acting first, about 15 feet away from the creature at the moment. What is it you would like to do? Or 20 feet away, what would you like to do?
I take the trident out from my back, place it to my chest, close my eyes, and says, Astylian, guide my hand as these vapor energy waves come off of my body like instinct Goku. I rush that motherfucker.
Okay.
I'm going to extra attack him, Max and Surge, and extra attack him again with my psionic force dive. 4 hits.
Okay, so you're using a... what weapon are you using again?
So here, using my trident.
Okay, so you're using your trident. What type of damage does your trident deal?
I know what you're about to do. Piercing. Okay. But
is the item damage a magical weapon?
I don't know, is it?
Do you have a magical trident? I don't believe you do in this campaign.
Piercing trident that you put magic through.
That's what I'm trying to determine, because if I put my sonic energy through it, does it make it magical? Does it not? I don't know.
Okay, so hang on. Because you said all your stuff at the same time, so we need to take this attack by attack. So what is it you're doing on your first attack?
I'm going to hit him with my trident and propel psionic power through it with a psionic strike, using one of my psionic die.
Okay, psionic strike. Hang on. At third level, use psionic energy to do psionic strike. Does this function as a free bonus attack that automatically hits? You propel your weapon with psionic force on each of your turns immediately after you hit a target within 30 feet of you with an attack and deal damage to it with a weapon. You can expend a psionic energy die. So you do not do that first. So, first things first, go ahead and roll the attack for your trident.
Okay. I know, I just shouted a bunch of shit because I'm very excited.
Yeah, I know.
Eighteen
does hit. Okay. You go to impact with the trident. You feel the impact against the creature, and you feel it sink into the flesh. But the flesh itself just repels the attack from the trident. No damage is dealt.
You won't let me do my psionic die?
Because you did not deal damage with the weapon, so therefore you cannot psionic with anything.
Oh, it's going to be like that, eh, Jordy?
So that is your first attack. You have a second one. But you didn't expend your psionic energy die. That's the big thing.
Okay. Just seeing some things here. So I get extra attack, but that's not necessarily an action. I can't grab, can I?
Correct. You cannot. It's when you make a melee attack, you get a second melee attack as part of the same action. So the only thing you can do is to attack it with the same weapon, essentially.
Right, but does no damage.
Correct.
So extra attack would be kind of useless at this point.
So reminder, Jules and Galahad, you two are on deck.
Can I grab? Is he? What is he wearing? Essentially, is he wearing like anything long?
He's wearing a fairly loose-fitting robe. It seems to be about down to, you know, halfway down his shins.
Loose-fitting robe. Could I attempt to, like, grab the trident and stab his... I was just saying, if he had a long coat, try to stab the coat to the ground, so at least he's, like, stationary for a while. But then he'd just be like, I took off the coat.
Yeah, exactly. So I'm just going to double-check something, because this one is a fun one. or grapple and attack. You could attempt to grapple him as your second attack as part of the same action if you would like.
Reduce his speed to zero. Then.
Okay, so that's going to be contested athletics. So you're rolling athletics, and I'm rolling athletics or acrobatics to contest it.
Okay.
Okay. It's not good. Oh, wait, I'm rolling the wrong dice.
Nah, were you rolling the murder dice?
No, I wasn't rolling the murder dice.
Well, did roll a d12 instead of a d12?
Did you just re-roll another roll?
Yeah, I'm rolling my NPC dice. They don't count for large creatures. So that was so that's a 14 for him.
16 for me.
16, okay. So he is currently grappled. His movement is zero. So let me pop
in after I kind of like go to sort of go for a stabbing strike with the trident, see it kind of skid off his skin like steel, shit, and kind of propelling with the motion of doing that, kind of grab him, like, weapons are very much not gonna hurt this guy, and I just start like trying to just hold him in place.
Okay, so you grabbing on your first attack, just effectively bouncing off him, shrugging off the attack, no damage dealt whatsoever, but you just realizing that it's not going to do anything, you take the trident and you just put it over the top of its head and just and hold it in place with the trident against its body, effectively grappling it, making its speed currently zero. There you go. So that's okay. Your action.
I will not action surge. I will do that.
That is a good call. So, on from there, we come to Jules and Galahad. Up to you guys, who's going first?
Yali can go.
Alrighty.
I should have known it would have been that simple, Jeff.
Cool.
Galahad, it never is with me.
Off the chair, onto the table, draws his sword, which is currently crackling with light, and just goes in for a swing.
Okay. Is your sword a magical sword?
Sure as fuck is. I cast magic weapon.
Oh, it did. You did.
Yes!
17? 17 does hit.
Let's go.
Yeah, baby!
He doesn't get advantage because it's grappled. That's not
Jordy, a Rakshasa is a fiend, correct?
Rakshasa is a fiend.
Yeah, it is! Extra D8, baby!
2, 3, 4. I'm gonna hit him with the bar.
Smack him, motherfucker.
Yes! Smite that bitch!
Yes!
And what weapon are you wielding again?
I am wielding a currently magically imbued longsword.
Magically imbued longsword, thank you.
All right. Okay. Plus. That's 30 points of radiant damage.
Ooh, 30 points.
You want to see me do it again?
Yeah. All right, go ahead and roll your second attack.
Thunderous boom, just like, Jesus Christ!
Oh, so close. But that's still a 25 to hit.
25 will hit.
Wakes you. Everybody else, natural get 18. Your popcorn. Galahad got this.
Get him mad!
That's more.
We were joking about him being the bodyguard, but I think he did a self-fulfilling prophecy here.
I feel like this is the day that he becomes Gala Dad.
Yeah.
He's always been Gala Daddy.
He's been Gala Daddy, now he's Gala Dad. And he's
Gala Dad. We get it. Galahad is like the Captain America of this group. We get it.
So, 33 points of radiant damage.
Oh! 33 points of radiant damage, okay. Good to know. So two heavy swings as Galahad, heavy footfall up on top of the chair, cracking the chair up on top of the table, heavy impact, the table itself buckling under the weight a little, and then two heavy overhand strikes to the grappled Rakshasa. You see that the searing pain from that, the radiant light striking and searing through in the body itself, turning this bright white yellow hot as sickly black and red ichor drips out of the wounds. And you can see he's already...
And then...
and just lets out a laughter.
Radiating off the blade, I do a flickering flourish.
Okay.
And I distribute... Nice, that is plus... Five. I distribute 6 temporary hit points to Nebula and 6 temporary hit points to Lisbon.
Right. Oh, so you guys have 6 temporary hit points each.
So much.
Excellent.
That's okay. My turn.
Good to know. So on from you, we come to Jules.
Last shot. Make it count. It's gonna go after you.
Yeah, I've got a sword. After the Eldritch Blasts and the Hex didn't work, Jules is gonna draw this plus one silvered sword that she got back in Stallmouse's lair from one of the rooms. I don't know if it's magical or not. I'm betting it's not, but she's gonna try and hit with this sword.
Okay.
That is a 4+6, or 4+2, which is a 6.
Okay.
Hey, nothing.
So for a 6, you take it out, and directly from where you are, you'd need to climb on top of the table to be able to hit him. but you are able to kind of clamber up on and just like, hi-yaka! And it just, tink, impacts against the shoulder, and then just kind of shrugs and just brushes the blade off of the shoulder.
Yeah, that's my turn. That's all I can do.
Thanos, and we're trying to hold the glove, get the glove off.
Yeah, that's all I can do. I got nothing. If I can't blast, I can't do nothing.
And you see him just kind of look around the room, and look at all six of you inside the close quarters, and specifically look at Galahad. Oh, sorry, go ahead.
Yeah, with missing, I'm just gonna back myself up into the corner to stay out of everybody's way.
Alright, so as you back away, because you had to get within 5 feet to attack him, he's going to make a swipe at you.
Alright,
I got
yeah.
him grappled though, no? Does that
so he still
not
gets
work?
To attack. So he's going to use a reaction.
The most deadliest T-Rex arms and
make a claw attack against you.
Backward T-Rex arms.
That's a 26 to hit.
It's 20. Yeah, that's going to hit.
Okay, so you take...
Oh yeah, no, it's speed zero. It can still attack. That's right.
Yeah. So you take 10 points of slashing damage. That's it.
That's it. That's all.
That was the reaction.
That was the reaction.
So now he's wasted his reaction on me.
But it is now his turn. As Galahad sinking two heavy, heavy blows into the chest of the Rakshasa, you can see the black ichor and the red ichor. You can see that already there's a little bit of disdain and pain across the face, and
I seemingly underestimated that one. That's fine. Another day, perhaps.
And you see him just raise a hand and just turn the hand. And as he does, the hand begins to coil in and upon itself, down the hand, down the arm, down the body. And all of a sudden, turning in place, he vanishes in front of you.
Damn it. Of course.
So.
So close. Angry.
I bet you if we had one more person to fight to hit him, it probably would have gone down.
No, I should have. I should have called out to Jules. Damn it.
But with that, as this Rakshasa, an entity that you now have confirmed is within the city, taking over the guise of the Watchmaster, vanishes from view. Six of you are left inside his dining hall. Dozen or so guards outside who saw him come in with you. What would you all like to do next?
We should get out of here.
Oh my god. I know what I should have done. Instead of grappling him, I should have tried to pry that stupid gen from his hand, because if there was contested strength, I would have done it.
It's true.
Fuck.
We need to get out of here. Tunnels?
Tunnels. Let's go.
Tunnels. The door and the fire, why don't we just go out the window?
We can.
The guards. But
the guards will be looking for us from now on.
I've got fog cloud ready to go. If we need a hasty escape, we could just be surrounded in fog and fucking let that obscure us as we make a getaway.
The guards only know that me, Galahad, and my uncle were here, so they don't know that you three were here, so it's best not to risk it. Let's just go through the tunnels and get out.
Or, we don't want your uncle involved. You are right. I don't want to get you into more trouble. And I feel like I can at least outrun a lot of the guards if, with the help of that cloud, do we want to make it look like I came in, attacked you all, and ran?
I don't think it'll matter that Rakshas is probably going to go and report us anyways, so.
But that's the thing. Why don't we just report it? And I transform back into the uncle. The situation that was seen was the three of us. The three of you could take the tunnels and get back out the way we've come before.
Why don't you just transform into the Watchmaster? You've heard his voice.
I have, and I could get clothing from here, but I'm unsure if the exact clothing he wore in is copyable here. Unless any of you are good at mimicking clothing.
Oh, it's his home. He's allowed to change.
I'm a talented seamstress.
I don't know. We've got a limited amount of time. The longer we're in here, the more suspicious it gets. I say we just...
You think they heard any of that outside, too?
Probably.
Probably the commotion, but that's about it. So we have a limited amount of time. I think that the easiest and quickest way is to have Zacharias...
Because, honestly, telling them out front what's happened, as Zacharias especially...
As city guards, they're charged with protecting the city. If there is a threat to the city, do you think that they would not take that lightly?
And we could certainly show them the tunnel to back up what we're talking about. We couldn't have just put that there. So regardless of what I explain to them, if they question, we can point out that his very home is connected immediately. So at the very
this ties it all together. That paints him in a very negative light.
I'm pretty sure he's either not really a person, or the person that we know has been dead for some time.
The food kind of backs that up.
Likely. That thing doesn't eat here.
I still think it would be smart for Les Paul, Phelan, and Margot to go through the tunnels. We'll meet back at the...
The doors are locked.
The doors are locked.
How about one of the windows at the back?
If I fuck up again, we get burnt down there.
Yeah, let's go out the window. I'll cast Fog Cloud. It'll block us from view, and we can make an escape and hide.
Your dog, Nebula. Anything you can do with that?
I think to Galaxy, and I say, window along the side, black curtain being pulled back now. Come. And so I request Galaxy to come to the window that I am opening, and I give exact locations.
And we just hear a in response, and eventually kind of looking out the window and just a little bit of a crack in it. You can see that eventually he carefully comes into view.
And once Galaxy's there, let me go ahead and roll.
That's how cool. We know.
Okay, so yeah, I'm going to use first off one of those for Galaxy to in.
So all of you see Nebula at the window, just kind of open it up just a little bit and give a bit of a view in, and then inside the room, the Galaxy just suddenly appears out of thin air, a little puff of white and gray smoke.
And I look to the group and say, come with me to one of the back windows.
Jules will take off her ring of obscuring and pass it to Les Paul, palming it into his hand and say, why use your strength when an object can do it? This will allow you to cast Fog Cloud.
Thanks.
Mac bomb ring.
So, one thing of clarification, Ring of Obscuring is an attunement item.
Ah, fuck. Then I don't give it to you. It's mine.
That's fine. It's okay. There you go. It's all right.
And, yeah, so I'll lead them all to the back window there, and I'll look out the back. And do I see anything out back?
Looking out the back, you see that there's a couple of guards seemingly less... trained on the building, more so looking down side alleys and things like that, but there is at least a guard presence
within, what is it, 40 feet from where it can see.
Yep.
Is there a spot that could be done without?
I can cast Fog Cloud at 120 feet.
Just to get outside the building, yes. To get to an area where, like, you have a straight shot away from the building and, you know, the guards aren't really going to notice you, not really.
I could cast it on them to obscure their vision as we bolt out of there.
I think Corso's got an ability he's trying to use right now. Something that he hasn't told us about because he's super sus right
now. It was something decided 10 minutes before we streamed.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Was a fuck?
I'm going to just lift up, yeah, because I don't want to step over what Dice is doing here, so I want to make sure that y'all can do this. I can see that guard, though, right?
Correct, you can. Yeah, there's just one guard that's kind of loosely paying attention to near to where that would go.
Watchmaster Tobias's face.
Okay.
Lift up the fucking window and lean out and go, "Oi! There's a commotion going on, I heard. Some drunks getting ready, a little too much on the festival. Go have a look. I can't be disturbed."
Make a deception check.
You're fucking right, I will.
That's my jail.
That is an unnatural 20.
All right, dirty 20. Back to my NPC dice.
What the fuck?
That is a 12. You just kind of, yes, sir. Right away, sir. Okay. And he just like is kind of looking around and is like, "Is anybody going to guard my post?" And he's just like looking and they're like, "Eh."
"Don't worry about it."
And he just, "Okay." And so he's like, "You nearby. Come with me." And the two guards that would be blocking your way are now vacated. And you seem to have a clear shot down an alley.
Professional.
Cool. And I tell the three to come. Is this like a window we could fit through or is it like a small window?
No, it's a window you could fit through.
Okay. Well, still, I summon forward first Les Paul. And since Les Paul, I say...
Bonjour, Les Paul.
Place your hand on Galaxy.
All right.
And I give Galaxy the command out there. And as you do, Galaxy, as my steed, pulls you... outside.
What?
Holy crap.
So, as Nebula leans down and Galaxy just kind of nods a little bit and you grab onto the collar and then you just blink and you just feel yourself rapidly pulled forward and like your body just kind of sucked through a very narrow tube, like you kind of lose your breath as if it's knocked out of you for a second and then you pop back into existence about 40 feet away.
These bitches cray.
And
okay. So you're 40 feet away from the building now. With a straight shot down an alley.
Okay. And then are you wanting me to cast Fog Cloud like near the window or?
Whatever you want to do, I just wanted to give you the space to do what you need. / you're the first one who's now at like a vantage point and you can see things that we can't from inside the house.
I guess so.
You can see, I'll tell you, you can see from the back of the house the window that you blinked out of and then eventually through. There is definitely view on that window specifically. The place that you blinked to now doesn't really have any guards or anybody watching it specifically. So it's getting from that point A to point B without being detected. That would be the difficult part.
Okay. It's a 40-foot gap from that window to the alleyway?
It would be about a 30-foot gap. You're about 10 feet into the alley.
Okay. Well, then I could try to cast Fog Cloud to try to get the most distance from the window to however 20 feet of a radius it would be for them to be able to get across and try to dart the extra 10 feet out.
Is it a 20-foot radius or 20-foot length?
I believe
it's a 20-foot radius, that's the whole distance.
That's 40 feet.
That's 40 feet.
Yeah. Oh, okay. Let me just double check.
You just Fog Cloud corridor.
20-foot radius.
Yeah, 20-foot radius. So you're able to fog the whole way out.
All right.
If you wanted to do that.
Yeah, definitely do that.
All right. So as Les has blinked outside, all of you looking, and with Galaxy gone and Les having vanished from inside the room, you look outside and you're able to see him on the other side and kind of coming to his senses, turn around and get a quick bearing, get down low to the ground. I got this. And then reach out, and all of a sudden a fog cloud just begins to swell out of the ground, and it kind of grows, and almost like morning dew, it just grows and grows and grows until it becomes a site where it is fully covering any kind of movement beyond it. And you are starting to hear at this point shouts of, hey, what's going on? Is there fire over there? Fire, fire, what's going on? So you guys have got, you've got a moment to do it, but you've got to get out quick.
Yeah, let's go. Running out. Action bonus action dash, baby.
All right.
Let's go.
So all of you using your action, your bonus action, dive through the window, hop up on the other side, get into the alleyway behind the building, having left it now completely empty with the exception of the rug that is overturned with the trap door open. And you guys slink off, and I need all of you to roll stealth checks for me to try and get away successfully.
That's how I know I fucked up.
Well, then that exposes the Watchmaster. If someone finds a secret cult door,
they're gonna get burned. Though we're gonna get like spicy people. Also, 20 stealth. All right,
so Margo stealth
16.
Phelan
19.
23. Galahad
plus 0, and that was a disadvantage. And I rolled a 16 and a 14.
Nice. Nebula
19.
Jules.
Oh, me? Oh. Sorry, stealth.
That's what you think.
17 plus 2.
19? Less?
I'm already there.
Oh, yeah, you're already there. Well, no, because you guys are trying to get away at this point. It's not stealth to get through the fog. It's to try and get away without anybody tracing tracking you.
My mistake.
Yeah.
Leave it to me. That was the worst one. That's a 8.
8, okay. It's a fucking 7. So,
oh my god!
Yeah, 7 on the die. So, having created the fog cloud and created enough of a diversion that they seem to think something, the grounds are on fire, something was dropped, you know, maybe a couple of candles that were for the celebration were released into the grass, you're not entirely sure, but the six of you slinking away into the alley behind the Watchmaster's home, having had your first interaction with a Rakshasa whose name you still do not know, but you have confirmed that the Rakshasa is inside the city.
Tiger hands.
And that is going to be where we pick up next week, as you guys have escaped away from that area, and we're going to see what direction you decide to go.
I could have fucking killed him!
You think?
Could have, would have, should have.
This move has second form.
Chat, I'm so sorry. I should have used your inspiration for the fucking initiative. I
should
have.
Oh,
no! We had 18.
So the question is that if those of us that didn't even get a chance in combat for inspiration, does it expire or do we still have it on deck?
So it's a bit of a weird one. I'm going to say if you didn't have a chance in combat, it carries over. Haley, you'll get one of your two. You won't get both. But yeah, if you did not have a chance in combat and if you had an inspiration die, I'll say that you have that for next week as well. Because obviously this was like near to the end of the stream. The chat, I don't want to screw you guys. Actually, you know what? No. Ah, no. Because I can refund chat.
Oh!
Their viewer rewards. So I'm going to do that instead.
You get a refund. You get a refund.
Yeah.
No, I don't want the refund. I want to get it. Don't take it.
Just come back in 2 weeks and give it to us again. Queue. Pretty please?
Yeah,
I'm
exactly.
I'm so mad to try to take that key away from him. I should have just fucking grabbed it from his.
All right.
There's so many things that could have been done in that could have completely changed that outcome.
So, Les, you didn't use your initiative, right?
I didn't use my inspiration.
Okay, so we're going to refund those. Jules, you didn't use yours either.
I didn't, no.
Okay, Nebula, you didn't use yours. Galahad, you didn't use yours.
Didn't have one.
You did.
Yeah, you did.
You just didn't use it.
Well, I didn't need it.
Margo got rejected. Phelan got rejected. And Margo got rejected. There you go. So, yeah, so you guys didn't use a single inspiration die tonight, I don't think. At least from what chat gave you. But
I'm so sorry, chat. It could have changed everything.
Could have been interesting, we'll say that. But regardless, you at least put a Rakshasa in a position that it had to flee from its own domicile, which is enough to say at a level 5 group, with one character not being able to do any damage whatsoever, a second character not being able to do anything whatsoever. This is going to be an interesting one to see where this goes. I mean, I hate to say it, this this feels like the Galahad show featuring the rest of the Faelai.
I am here for it. I will be your number one fan.
Here's the thing, Jules.
Well, that's not true. I'm sorry, Phelan. I'm glad you didn't get a chance to go. We're gonna put it that way.
No, I am more than happy to sit at the sidelines and cheer Galahad on as long as we don't die.
No, this is Galahad and the Pussycats, and Galahad is Josie. We are Pussycats.
Would that have derailed a lot for you, Jordy, had we murdered this thing right now?
No, not at all.
If I could.
The whole point. So yeah, so we can talk about this after, but a Rakshasa is an entity that is incredibly powerful, is not incredibly powerful on its own.
Yeah.
Interesting.
What do they usually hang out with?
Well, there was six guards outside.
There were also all the dogs and the things downstairs. Yeah.
Exactly. And a room that you were not able to get to, and two other rooms behind locked doors. So
there's at least one bat out there too.
Okay, but here's
one. No, you killed it. You killed it.
Me and Jules can literally do nothing. Nothing.
Well, no, you have your claw. Your
I got my claw and my squishy 37 hit points.
I was so excited too, Jordy. I was like, I'm gonna bonus action hex this motherfucker. I'm gonna hit him with two Eldritch Blasts. I'm gonna use my new Eldritch Invocation to push him 10 feet. I'm gonna deal Agonizing Blast, which is plus my Charisma. And then when my turn comes around again, I'm gonna bonus action to use my my other new Eldritch Invocate. But no!
So the thing here was, and this is what made me really sad, is because you pop Divine Sense, and Divine Sense is not a spell. The Rakshasa can't be affected or detected by spells of 6th level or lower. So because Divine Sense is not a spell, you can see him. But everything else just vanished into the ether. But with that, we're going to go ahead and let you guys go for the night. Thank you so much, everybody in chat. Thank you to all the raiders. Thank you to everybody who joined in. A whole bunch of new followers tonight. We appreciate you guys so much. I love doing this campaign. It is one of my babies, and I'm so happy that we're at the point now of getting seriously interesting with some shit. And I'm curious how you guys are going to navigate now the political side of things next week, because you've got the rest of the day and the whole festival ahead of you, and the Watchmaster is gone after going into a building.
Well, not only am I screwed in combat, I'm screwed in socializing. This is just
you're the most charismatic. You're going to be the highest charisma, least charismatic character I've ever seen play. It's amazing. But we love you guys very much. Thank you so much for tuning in tonight. Definitely want you to come back in two weeks.
Tune in Saturday.
We got Saturday for Chromatic Dragon Saga. We've got this coming Monday as well for Beyond the Realms coming back, which is going to be great. Start of a new arc for them. But from our side, thank you so much for everybody for tuning in. We appreciate you guys. Stay happy. Stay healthy. Wash your hands. Wear a mask. We love you very much. And we'll see you back here soon.
Bye. Bye-bye.